what's up, everyone? You're listening to Striking a Chord with Madd Manda on TVK Radio. So welcome to episode one of what I hope is going to become a successful podcast that gets people talking and hopefully one that people are going to enjoy. With me is our TVK editor and basically all around handyman, so to speak, producer of the show. What's going on, Rich?
Man of many hats. That's what I actually have. That's what I have on my bio, on my business cards. Anytime I sign something, it's man of many hats.
I think that's a perfect description for you.
It's a good week for music. This is a good week to debut a new show. Planet Comic Con. We're coming off the heels of C2E2. Planet Comic Con's this weekend.
Yeah, there's a lot going on.
A lot.
So let's talk about what people listening, if there's anybody listening, I hope, you can expect from the podcast in upcoming episodes. So we're going to be discussing new music releases. Obviously, that's a big thing. My pick of the week, which I'm calling Manda's music pick. It's just basically whatever album or song I'm currently obsessed with this week. And then,
will any of those ever be a song from like the 70s or 80s, just out of curiosity?
No, it's usually something new.
I had to ask.
It's a fair question that people need to know.
Because I'm obsessing right now over some 80s and 90s music, but that's a whole nother argument.
That definitely is. We're also going to be doing a segment I'm calling On the Road, which is basically just us filling you in on the latest tour and festival announcements, stuff that we're excited about. Oh. And we're also periodically going to be checking in with some friends in Nashville to see what's happening in Music City. We're calling that the Nashville Drop-In. And then, of course, we're going to have a feature segment, which is basically where we're going to be digging into either a specific artist's back catalog, or we're going to be discussing one specific album that's become a classic. Or, like today, we're going to be picking a theme and curating a list between the two of us based on our personal picks, and we're going to discuss and debate them till we can't talk anymore.
I have done numerous lists for numerous episodes of Live, SNS, The Winos, every show we've done, I have come up with a list for. Today has been the hardest list I have ever had to come up with.
Yeah, it was, you know, it started off easy, like what I thought it was going to be.
Oh, come on, you had like 66 of them, and we'll get to that, but you had like 66, and I'm sitting over here going, I've got four?
It got really hard once I started like needing to like narrow it down to 10, because there's so many albums that have like just made a huge impact.
You could do a honorable mention and be okay, but I swear to you, if there's 116 on the honorable mentions list, we're going to have a long discussion.
Yeah, but so I think we're getting ahead of ourselves. We haven't told people what the theme is yet.
Nope, but that's more fun. So you just have to stick around for that.
So starting off, we're going to do our new music alert first.
All right. I got no sound here yet. this is a brand new show. Sound effects are coming in when I edit on later on after we record.
Yes. So new music that came out technically didn't come out last week, but within the last couple weeks. Maren Morris's second album, Girl.
Which is fantastic, by the way. Phenomenal. I sat down and went, okay, so she's one of those artists that I'm new to. And mostly because I heard her on pop radio. Like, I know you've talked about her, but she's one of those. I'm just now rediscovering country again, because after I worked at a country music radio station, I quit listening for about 3 or 4 years. I was tired of the type of country, frat country.
Oh, bro country.
Yeah, bro. I just couldn't do it. And
yeah, a lot of people couldn't.
I went away from it. I decided to go, you know what, I'm gonna step away from listening to country music and go to a different style, which is kind of hard, especially when you listen to everything sometimes country is going to seep in. And I'm glad that there's all these new artists coming around that you have introduced me to.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely a wide variety to pick from. Sadly, though, and we've discussed this before, country radio needs to stop, like, get their head out of their ass and start playing more more women on country radio.
I could go in on a whole thing about the American, is it the Academy? No, it's the ACMs, right?
Yeah,
it's
the ACMs, which are coming up.
Fun story. I actually did a lot of research on that. I have something planned. I don't know if it's going to end up being an article or a show or an episode of one of my shows, but I did a lot of research on how mad I am about the ACMs.
Yeah, it's a whole thing. A lot of people were in an uproar. And it's not to take away from anyone who was nominated, because congratulations. I mean, that's amazing. But they have a long way to go before anyone's going to be truly happy with the nominees.
Yeah, Maren Morris's new album, though, it's going to be an anthem album. I just have that feeling.
Bringing it back to it, yes, Maren Morris's second album, Girl, is just phenomenal. Track by track, there's not a single skip worthy song on there. But we're going to get more into Maren Morris's second album in a minute, because that's actually Manda's music pick this week.
Oh, so it doubles this week. I've been obsessed
with that album.
When you posted that, I went, every time you post some new music somewhere, I'm going, I probably should go listen to that.
Yeah, and I hope that that's what people take away from it. That's the majority of what my Instagram is full of, just music suggestions.
I got to give you, I told Brody the same thing, because I just gave him the powerful password of Twitter. I'm going to give it to you as well as our Instagram. Because I need help with social media, because our social medias are growing. TBK Magazine on Twitter, TBK Mag on Instagram, and Facebook.com/TBK Magazine. Go ahead.
Yes, for sure.
Sorry, I had to do that.
No, it's perfect. And then as far as other new music, for our new music alert, so there's this songwriter, Jamie Grooms, and he is one of the songwriters on Jacob Bryan's debut album. And he is awesome. He's so talented. Super humble guy. He released an album this past week called Just a Drunken Vessel. And he's actually one of our new and exciting artists to watch for. He's not new, depending on how well you follow the country genre. But if you haven't heard of him yet, go listen to this album. It's so full of genuine, honest stories. His songwriting is amazing. The music is amazing. Just the whole album is it'll like hit you right in your feelings, basically. So I definitely recommend listening to him. Josh Phillips, who's another singer-songwriter, released a new song called In a Bar Somewhere. Don't judge it by the title. It's actually a very, very good song. It may sound like a bro country kind of title, and I get that, but it's really not. It's really, 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 really good.
New music for me for 2019 has not settled in yet. I've listened to songs. I've not listened to whole albums other than Maren Morris's. I'm kind of excited for Lana Del Rey.
Oh, really?
Yeah, which that probably shocks somebody out there.
I'm sure somebody somewhere is shocked.
No, I enjoy a lot of different music. And I actually found a band who released an album at the end of 2018. And that's who I've been listening to recently.
Okay, who's that?
Valley of Wolves.
Huh. And how would you describe them?
Indie. 100% okay. Indie.
Indie like art rock?
Yeah, indie art rock. They kind of fall in that new sound. Like, there's this sound I feel with pop rock going on right now that may not be the most mainstream popular sound that's been around ever.
Yeah.
But I appreciate this sound.
Huh. Well, that's good.
That's my new music pick to help you. Or I guess that's my album. I don't know how this goes. This is all new to me.
No, it's cool. Two other artists on my new music alerts. OAR, their new album comes out next Friday, and I swear, I've been anxiously awaiting this new album. They released three songs off of it earlier, last month, I think, and they're awesome. One of them went number one on Pulse Radio for Sirius XM, if anyone's listening. Miss You All the Time. Amazing song.
That's them?
Yes, that's them. Sorry. That's OAR.
I did not. Okay, I'm going to sit back now.
Yeah, most people remember OAR from their college days. They were a jam rock band, and some of their songs still are, but they gradually over the years kind of geared more towards like pop rock. But they still stay true to who they've always been. They're amazing. Mark Roberge, lead singer, I saw him at City Winery in January or February, and one of the best shows I've ever been to.
Intimate shows are awesome.
Yeah, they're my favorites. He played a song, and this was acoustic, mind you. He played a song off of the new album that he had never played before, and they just released it, I want to say, last week or the week before, off of the new album, and it's called All Because of You. If you have not heard this song yet, seriously, you need to go listen to it. Like, this is one of those songs, it's like the epitome of why I'm so passionate about music. It will make you cry, because when he played it at City Winery, I kid you not, it was so quiet. For the first time that whole night, it was so quiet. You could literally hear like a pin drop. It brought tears to my eyes sitting there listening to him sing it. I can't wait to hear the rest of the album.
powerful music is amazing, especially in 2019. Because yeah, exactly. Sometimes the escape from the world and music is that appropriate escape most of the time.
Exactly. And that's why I love it so much. Last artist on my new music alert list, Nikita Carmen, who's, if you're following TBK, she's no stranger to us. We've covered her before. She's a phenomenal singer-songwriter. She's got a new song out right now called, I believe it's called Our Thing. It's great. It's like pop country rock, I want to say. I don't really know how to describe it. It's just good. You can't like put her in a box.
I appreciate artists like that.
Go listen to it.
I appreciate artists like that a lot.
Yeah.
I will find
that. So unless you have more new music for our new music alert, we can kind of dig into Maren Morris's album.
That pretty much sums up my new music. I don't... I'm weird. So how I discover new music is usually through you. And...
I love that.
It's through you and the occasional, hey, look, have you heard this song? Or I'll go down the rabbit hole and follow. If you like this artist, you'll like this artist. And you'll like this artist.
Yeah, that's a lot of what I do.
That's how I discovered a lot of different bands.
Yeah.
So, now let's talk about Maren Morris's album.
Oh, God, this album. She has been working on it for a long time now. And her and Ryan Hurd, her husband, who's also another singer-songwriter in country music, have been tweeting and talking about it and like hinting at, like teasing about it for months leading up to its release, and for good reason. Like, it's just, it's so good. And what I love about it is it's a lot of, not to like scare off the male fans, but this album is like, it's just so much like female emotion. Like, it's basically like every emotion that goes along with being a female. But that's not to say that like somebody else couldn't relate to some of the songs on here. Like, my favorite song on this album is track 4, A Song for Everything. It's one of those songs that's literally, it's like a love letter to all of our favorite songs. You have to hear it if you haven't listened to it yet. And if it weren't for licensing issues, we could play it for you right now, like a snippet. But
I mean, I can get away with so much time. I mean, I've got rights to music, but I can only play so much time before it's like, yeah, no, you're going to get cut. So
right, exactly.
Yeah.
So just if you haven't heard it yet, which you might be living under a rock if you haven't, seriously, go listen to it. It's just, I can't say enough good things about this album. And it crosses so many genres.
Well, she already
does it so well.
I was gonna say, she already stepped across the plane from country to pop.
Yeah, when she did that collaboration with Zedd and Grey, with The Middle, which was huge. If you don't know that song, you're definitely like,
You're on one side of the fence on that song. You either love that song or you hate that song. I don't feel like there is a middle, no pun intended.
No, there's definitely not. I love that song. And I still, like, when it comes on, like, I don't change it. It's just, it's not old. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that
like,
just got added to my playlist. Okay, so that's sad. It just got added to my playlist.
Not
because I forgot, but because you'll hear a song on the radio and go, oh, I want to put that on my playlist. Then later on, you'll just forget that it's there.
Yeah. I've gotten in the habit of Shazamming stuff. Even if I know what it is, I'll Shazam it. And then like, so I can go back and remember to put it
on
my playlist.
So fun story. You can actually sync your Shazam up to your playlist depending on what music profile you have. And I did that. So that's how I've got it.
I did that recently too.
Worth it. I think my favorite song is To Hell and Back.
Oh, that was going to be my next one I was going to talk about. Such an incredible song. Obviously, a lot of the, probably most of the love songs on this album were inspired and written about her husband, Ryan Hurd. But To Hell and Back, God, if that's not like the song we all want to live out, like, I don't know what is.
You want to talk about someone else, by the way, who, and I know this goes against just the music itself, but I love Maren Morris's music videos.
Yeah.
Because every one of them has been fantastic. So yeah, I'm waiting for all
very
of these.
Hands in.
Yeah, I'm waiting for all of these to come out for the music videos for this, because I know Girl just got released.
Oh, God. That song. It's such an anthem for women. I love it.
It is. The music video is good, too. But I don't know if anything's ever going to top Rich for me, because with her music videos, because that's like that's an amazing music video if you've not seen it.
The sad part is that there were people who were like taking it seriously and like tweeting at her and like going off on her and stuff. And it's like, really? Do you not get that this is supposed to be like comical? Like, what's the word I'm looking for?
Satire.
Yeah. Thank you. Satirical.
That's why I'm here.
People are just stupid these days. Like, I don't know.
No, go ahead. No. I'm 100. I'll toast you while I drink my beer. No, that's 100% true. People are stupid on social media sometimes.
And they give her a lot of flack. And I mean, I get it. People think that she's not traditional country, whatever. Look, she's got the voice. She can cross out genres just as easily as Shania Twain did, as Taylor Swift did, as Faith Hill did. I mean, she can do it. She's done it. She's doing it her way. She doesn't like. She's all about like having her own hands in everything she does. She's not listening to anyone else unless she genuinely like values their opinion, like her husband and close singer songwriters to her, like the Brothers Osborne guys and Lucy Silvis. You know. So other than that, if you don't like it, you don't have to listen to it. It's that easy. Like, it's that simple.
Why is it that when a female artist releases a very powerful album, such as this, it seems to just get this instant backlash from what people think, from what people say they're the hardcore country fans? It's always been a baffle to me.
Yeah, I don't understand it either. It never used to be like this, like we've talked about before, like
90s country,
early 2000s. But for whatever reason, women just get this, like this.
There's a stigma.
Yeah, the stigma around them.
Because I'm not the biggest Gretchen Wilson fan. Like, I mean, I enjoy her music to a point, but I don't think she could survive today.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I haven't heard anything recently from her, so I can't judge her on today's standards. But I mean, her music then in the 2000s was great. I liked it. I enjoyed it. Whether or not she could stand today, I don't know, to be honest with you.
It's kind of weird to go back and look at all the powerful women and then go, could they actually have been played on country radio today? And about 90% of them get to no, and that's really sad.
Yeah, it really is. And then you have artists who are incredibly talented, Maren Morris, Kelsey Ballerini, and, you know, so many others. And they get hated on because they're too pop. Well, there's a lot of male artists on country radio right now that are like pop or still kind of bro country. And people who I'm not even all that impressed by, like they're at the top of the charts. And I don't know why.
I guess I'm going to do the same thing I did for the other new shows that have been released lately. I'm going to play the bad guy. I don't care. There is a certain country artist group that's two people that I do not understand the appeal for. And I can't think of their name right now to save my life, which that helps. But
it's not Florida Georgia Line, is it?
It is. I know. But I get it, but they're not country either.
Yeah, so...
They're
I have
pop.
A love-hate relationship with Florida Georgia Line. And this is probably going to inspire another future episode, like overrated, underrated artists.
Oh, they're 100% overrated.
Just in country music alone.
They're 100% overrated. I'll just go ahead and argue this.
I mean, when they came out, their first album, Here's the Good Times, fell in love with the album. I thought it was the freshest out. It changed country. They're one of those artists when people look back, they're going to say Florida Georgia Line changed country music. Now, whether or not people think they change it for the better or worse, you're either on one side of the fence or the other. There's a few people like myself who kind of find themselves somewhere in the middle of that fence. And that's where I'm at right now with them. Their last album I thought was good. It had some great songs on it. When you hear the album, you don't think of it as a country album. When you see them live, you get to see the steel guitar and the instruments and you know, that they're playing and everything. And they're great performers. They're entertainers, 100%. With this new album, I don't know what they were thinking, because they kept advertising it as it's the most country thing we've done. Well, no, that I don't see how that's possible. Because there's songs on there where I'm just like, what?
and that goes along with an artist like with Maren Morris's album that's so, I believe, more country sounding than the people who are associated with country right now.
Well, not just country in the sound, but the lyrics. Like, and that's the whole thing, is people forget that, like, so Florida Georgia Line's last album before this new one, it may not have sounded traditionally country, but the lyrics were very country. The stuff that they talked about, you know, growing old, you know, with their wives, and just that's, you know, all that kind of stuff. Maren Morris, her new album, it may have some, you know, R&B flavor here and there, and it may have some pop sounds. But if you dig deep into the lyrics, I mean, there's nothing not country about it. Just because she's not talking about a truck or a bonfire or drinking beer doesn't mean it's not country.
The three staples apparently to every country song.
Yeah, like, I'm sorry, like, I love the country genre, but there's this stereotype surrounding it. You know, back in the 90s, it used to be, oh, well, country music is just about, you know, my husband or my wife cheated on me, and my dog died, and my truck died, you know, and I don't know what's worse, that stereotype or the stereotype today, where it's like, you know, oh, well, it's just about drinking beer and tailgates and bonfires, and no, that's not it either. Like, people aren't getting it, and I blame certain entertainment websites that
not that us
get off on promoting this, what they believe the country lifestyle is.
Country music is about the lyrics. Go back to the day. Go way exactly. back to the day. To the days of Johnny Cash and Willie Nelson and the gods of country. Look, there's a Mount Rushmore of country music. Their faces are on it.
Yeah, exactly.
But it wasn't the sound. You listen to the lyrics and it would, you could relate.
Exactly. And I think that's the problem today. You know, like, even my dad, like, him and I would constantly get into a debate about this. Like, oh, well, today's country music isn't really country. Well, some of it, no, may not be country. But, and as much as I agree, there's never going to be country like there was in the 90s. I get it. Like, the 90s country was the best. But you can't take away from what these artists today are doing. Like, they are breaking, you know, they're pushing boundaries and they're bending the rules and they're doing it their own way and they're, you know, people like Alan Jackson and Garth Brooks and George Strait, they were inspired by people who came before them, older people. Whereas the artists that are coming out now, they're our age or younger. And so they're not just inspired by those classic country artists, but they're also inspired by, you know, people like Usher and the Backstreet Boys and, you know, just different, just like pop artists. I mean, Kelsey Ballerini comes from Knoxville, Tennessee, but she loves pop music. And a lot of these artists do, especially a lot of the song suffragettes. But they're country. I mean, you can't, if we get too caught up in the sound and trying to pinpoint the genre, we lose the value of the music itself. The people aren't paying attention. I think that's what's happening now.
Where Maren Morris's album is completely in the, like, it, the lyrics are 100% country. The sound might be pop.
Right.
But it still has, I like to call it pop with a twang.
Yeah, exactly.
It's what would happen if your friend got drunk and they tried to hide their Southern accent and they get drunk and then their Southern accent decides to just randomly come out.
Yeah, I'd say that's a pretty good description.
Yeah, that's pop country to me.
Before we go off on any more tangents, because I feel like this could be a whole other episode in and of itself.
Well, I knew this was going to happen. It's just, it's one of our podcasts. I knew eventually a tangent would happen. No matter who's on the show, eventually tangents will happen.
Some of the other great songs on Maren Morris's album, I mean, they're all fantastic, but ones that really stuck out to me, we talked about A Song for Everything, To Hell and Back. The Bones is a really, really great song. And if you don't think that's country, then I don't know what's wrong with you. Gold Love is fantastic.
If you don't think this album's country, 25% tells me that you probably enjoyed Chinese Democracy from Guns N' Roses.
Yeah, I agree.
That's where I'm going.
It's just a fantastic, like, I know I keep using these same basic words, but, I mean, without digging, like, super deep into it for, you know, an hour.
No, because we probably could.
Yeah. All I can say is, I mean, go listen to it yourself. I've listened to it multiple times, front to back, have not skipped a single song.
It's very rare for me to put an entire album on my playlist. And I'll let you know how rare it is. I have 6 total. I now just added a 7th.
Maren Morris.
Yeah. I really like this album a lot. Like, this is an anthem album for anybody. And anytime I ride with somebody, I'm going, yeah, they're going to enjoy this too.
Yeah, it definitely is. I mean, she just completely nailed it. And what's even better is she did it her own way. I can't stress that enough. Like, she did it her way. She threw the rule book out. She threw out what everyone else was trying to tell her to do. Whether it gets her airplay or not, she did it her way. She made the music she wanted to make. And, I mean, fans are loving it.
So I want you to know, they're in Google. If you Google this album, that comes up with a more like this. Mm-hmm. One of the albums on there is the Platinum Collection from Queen.
Really?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
That's just, that one caught me off guard.
Yeah. I don't really get where they're going with that, but okay.
I'm okay with it, though.
So unless we have any more gushing to do about Mary Morris's album, without repeating ourselves, I guess we can go move on to On the Road. Exciting concert and festival announcements.
Understatement of the year.
I'll let you start on this one.
The lineup for Lollapalooza just got announced, which is in Grant Park in Chicago.
Yes, it's huge, like massive.
I've told myself I need to go to a music festival again. I haven't been to one in years. And
really?
Yeah, I have not been to a full 3-day music festival or 4-day music festival in probably 5 to 10 years. Maybe 10. Like, I think the last time I went to one might have been Ozfest.
Oh my God.
It's been a while.
Yeah, because you went to Warped Tour last year, didn't you?
But Warped Tour is a 1-day thing.
Oh, that's right. I forget. Damn.
Yeah, no, I haven't been to an actual music festival in a long time. And then I saw the lineup for Lollapalooza and went, you know, Chicago's not that far away from me. I might have to make that trip.
People get nuts at Lollapalooza. Like, it gets cray-cray. And I hate to use that term, but...
Did you just say cray-cray on a show?
For humor purposes, I'm going to say, like, shit gets weird at Lolla.
I want to make this statement. This is one of the coolest lineups I've ever seen for a music festival because it is every genre is represented. Yeah, no, wait. I don't know if you've seen the lineup, but every genre is represented.
I glanced at it. Like, I didn't give it, like, a full, like, detailed, like, review. But,
So I'll cover...
Jay-Z's on there, right?
No, that's Woodstock.
Oh, okay.
Lollapalooza. I'll do like the top lines.
Okay.
Because there are bands that are in the smaller print that I'm more excited about. Like Fits in the Tantrums. I'm a huge Fits in the Tantrums fan.
Okay. That's random.
Yeah, no, I love them. They're going to be at Lollapalooza.
Interesting.
So off the bat, Ariana Grande, which I love.
Yeah.
I know you're not the best. Childish Gambino. 21 Pilots. The Strokes, who I didn't know were still around.
I was just about to say that.
The Chainsmokers.
Okay, yeah.
Jay Balvin? Ooh. I don't know who that is.
Casey
Musgraves.
I've heard the name mentioned.
Casey Musgraves.
Okay.
Meek Mill, Hozier, Jose. I don't know how to... Tenacious D?
I didn't know they were still a thing.
Yeah. Death Cab for Cutie. Wow. 21 Savage. Like, it is weird. This might be one of the weirdest lineups I've ever seen. Slash.
Yeah, it definitely is.
Slash.
Oh, wow. I didn't know he was going to be there.
Yeah, that makes me even more want to go.
I saw Miles Kennedy was going to be there with his band, but I didn't know Slash.
It's Slash featuring Miles Kennedy and the Conspirators.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. It's Bring Me the Horizon. Again, you could go all the way down this list and went, yeah, this might have to happen.
So who are you most excited for?
Besides Fits in the Tantrums?
Yeah.
Because that, ironically, Tenacious D, I've never seen them live. They seem like they put on a fun show, especially in that setting. Mm-hmm. I feel that would be the way to see them.
In college, the guys I worked at the radio station with, they were obsessed with Tenacious D, and they would play it constantly. And I was just like, huh, okay. I don't get it, but okay.
No, I mean, they're funny, but I want to see Fits in the Tantrums live. I want to see the Chainsmokers. They've grown on me a lot lately.
Yeah, I've heard the Chainsmokers put on a really great live show.
I think this is one of those lineups that caters to every music fan, which, by the way, if you're a fan of festivals, that never happens.
True.
So, I mean, there's a lot of artists. I'll put the link up for the... in the description for the poster, because there's a lot.
another tour that got announced last week, which we've talked about this a little bit during our 90s podcast episode of TBK Live, but Alice Cooper is coming back, and he's bringing Hailstorm to co-headline, and this freaking tour is going to be insane.
This is the tour of the year for me.
Oh, I can't wait. I've already got the tickets. Like, I'm hoping to try and get an interview with either. This tour is going to be insane.
Let me tell you this now. If you get an interview with a certain female guitarist, you're taking me. I'm going to tell everyone that I'm just, you're vetoing them going. I am going. Because I love Nita Strauss.
You have to buy tickets to come to Chicago.
That's not that difficult, trust me.
I'm just making sure you do it.
Well, I don't know. I know they're going to be in St. Louis, which is a little easier drive for us. And it's an outdoor venue, which makes it just a little bit cooler.
Well, this one's outdoor, too.
Oh, is it? Ooh, outdoor in Chicago versus outdoor in St. Louis. There's not a difference there. But the one in St. Louis is next to a casino. So, hey.
Oh, well.
But, yeah, no. I this is probably the biggest concert I'm looking forward to this year other than Elton John.
Yeah, it definitely shocked me because they kept announcing, Hailstorm kept announcing all these tour dates and Chicago was on there. And I was like, how could they not come back to Chicago? It's been at least a year, maybe more, since they've been here. In actually Chicago, like not like, you know, Rockford or something like that. And then I saw Alice Cooper, Hailstorm, and my mind was blown. I cannot wait for this tour.
That's a super show. That is a super show of music. You've got the present day rock band who is tearing up the scene with the past who's still pretty much kicking ass at whatever age Alice Cooper is.
Oh, God, I want to say he's in the 70s, but
he's
be wrong.
He's got to be 60. He's got to be in his late 60s or early 70s.
Yeah, at least.
And still looks the same.
Yeah. I mean, he takes care of himself. You know, he lays off the drugs and the alcohol. He golfs. He has
I just cannot picture Alice Cooper playing golf.
Oh, my God. I don't know if he has an Instagram or not, but like, go like Google him. You'll see him golfing. Like, he's known for golfing.
Please, for the love of God, tell me he's wearing golf pants. That's all I ask for in life.
Oh, I'm pretty sure he wears a golf outfit when he goes golfing.
Holy cow.
I know I've seen pictures before.
He does. His pants are really high-waisted. That's the weirdest thing I've ever seen.
He's like super intellectual, super intelligent.
I love Alice Cooper. Always have.
Yeah, for sure. It's not there anymore, but his restaurant, Cooperstown in Phoenix, was awesome. I loved it the one time I went there.
Before it closed, I'm guessing.
Yeah, it's closed since.
Anytime musicians get into the music or get into the food realm, the restaurant closes unless your name is Toby Keith for some reason.
Well, no, Toby Keith's place did close.
Not the one in Oklahoma City. Really? Yeah, I whatever his thing is, I love this bar or whatever it is still open in Oklahoma City, as far as I know.
So he's not actually. I learned this when his place in Chicago, Rosemont, closed. He's not actually associated with it. It went bankrupt because the management wasn't paying the bills, I guess. Like, employees showed up there and, like, the doors were closed. Like, people started taking stuff off the walls because they didn't think they were going to be getting a paycheck. It was pretty crazy.
Do you know that Willie Nelson owns a stake in Texas Roadhouse?
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
If you enjoy Texas Roadhouse and love you some Willie Nelson.
I do like Texas Roadhouse.
It's my favorite.
I do enjoy some Willie Nelson.
That's my favorite chain steakhouse. Let's do this.
Ours used to be Lone Star, but they since closed it here in Chicago, the one that we went to. So now we go to Texas Roadhouse.
It's a pretty good place. I love their. I don't know how we got into this, but you're talking about musicians and food for some reason. Now I just ate.
I just ate dinner. Now I could go for some Texas Roadhouse.
Their cinnamon butter is the jam.
Yes. Oh, my God. It's the best. I don't like cinnamon, but their cinnamon butter is the shit.
I have not heard you curse this much. Like, you've never cursed this much on live. Like, that's the show you curse on, and this is the one you drop.
I know, and I told myself I wasn't going to. That's probably the most you'll hear. I won't be dropping any F-bombs.
Just let you know, I've only said ass.
Yeah, we're good. You wanted to talk about Woodstock, so go ahead and give us a
lineup. Someone has told me that if I want to go to Woodstock, I got the opportunity.
Really? And I take it that's your wife that told you that?
No. This is someone I've been, it's a friend of mine who I've met through comic conventions,
mm-hmm.
who said if I want the opportunity, I'm more than welcome to take it and I can stay with them. So I'm like, ooh.
Wow.
And it's over my birthday weekend. It's in Watkins Glen, New York. Of course, the home of the original Woodstock.
Yeah.
But this lineup, I thought Lollapalooza's lineup was great. Woodstock's might be better.
Go ahead and give it to us.
Day one, The Killers, Miley Cyrus, Santana, The Lumineers, who else? Robert Plant.
Oh, wow.
Dorothy, who I'm a huge fan of.
Really?
Yeah, I love Dorothy.
I don't think I actually know who Dorothy is.
Rock band. Really great. Okay. Yeah, I'll send you a link. And then on Saturday, Dead and Company, Chance the Rapper, The Black Keys. Love The Black Keys. Sturgill Simpson, Greta Van Fleet, Portugal, The Man. Leon Bridges, Gary Clark Jr. There's just, I mean, there's more. I'm not going to go through everybody. David Crosby and Friends.
I think Woodstock's lineup definitely is probably better than Lawless.
And then Sunday, Jay-Z, Imagine Dragons, Halsey, Cage the Elephant, Brandi Carlile. Yeah. Young the Giant, Janelle Monáe, Common.
Wow. Yeah,
that's a lineup. A band called
Sunday's going to be the day everyone goes.
A band called Pussy Riot. Just wanted to say that. No, this is okay, so I remember Woodstock in the 90s and how much of a cluster smurf that was and how terrible that went down. This looks awesome.
Yeah, I was really surprised when I saw that they were bringing it back.
I was too. I didn't think they were going to ever do it again after the cluster that was the 90s, because that aired on Fox and I remember how trash that place was.
Oh my gosh. I mean, Lollapalooza, like Grant Park gets trashed after Lolla, but I mean, nothing compared to Woodstock.
Yeah, didn't they burn porta potties at Woodstock?
I just don't get it. Like, you people, and you wonder why we can't have nice things.
I don't expect that at this one. I really don't. The music's much. No. That was a much different time. Like, one of the headliners for that was Kid Rock.
Oh, wow.
This is more mellow music.
Yeah. I mean, and it's not that I necessarily think that the artists, you know, instigate like violence and everything. But I think some of these fans, they just get out and, you know, like my dad says, some people act like they've never been past the mailbox before.
You mean Kid Rock and Limp Bizkit just never did that for you? They never made you want to incite violence? Because I've heard their music. I wanted to incite violence.
I mean, Break Stuff, not going to lie. When you were having a bad day, that was the song you turned up.
That song is still on my list of day when I'm bad in a bad mood.
Yeah, agreed. But I mean, I would never burn a porta potty. You know what I mean? Like, what did the porta potty do to you? You know?
It talked a bunch of crap.
Dad jokes.
Yep. That's what you get. That's what you're getting from me right now as a co-host. It's just horrible dad jokes.
Yeah, I mean, I'm anticipating a lot of people going to Woodstock. And I mean, I'm sure it's going to be insane. The Sunday lineup alone is like massive.
I mean, Bonnaroo's also around that time too, I think.
That's right. I forgot about Bonnaroo. That's in Tennessee.
That's in June. Bonnaroo's in June.
Yes. Yes, because I remember it was the same weekend as, or same week that I went to CMA Fest 2 years ago.
You want to talk about, Bonnaroo's got a great lineup too.
Who's playing that?
Thursday, they're doing Grand Ole Opry.
Oh.
That's all it says. Like, I don't know anyone else. Friday, Fish. There's a band I haven't heard in a long time. Childish Gambino.
Again, these bands I never knew that were still around.
Childish Gambino, the Avett Brothers. This kind of looks like the same lineup that's at Lollapalooza in a way.
Slightly.
Post Malone's on Saturday. Kacey Musgraves, Hoser. The Lonely Island. Good gravy. And then on Sunday, Fish with, again, the Lumineers. Cardi B, Brandi Carlile. Oh, Walk the Moon. Hey, I love Cardi B.
I can't. I just can't with her.
Okay. I'll never do it.
Oh god, we've done Cray Cray and we've done Ochre.
It's that show. It's your debut show. Someone had to bring it off the rails a little bit. I apologize that it's me.
It's cool. Yeah, so I mean, festival season is coming up and I mean, it's gonna be insane.
Memphis in May is not that. You want me to tell you what the most disappointing one is? Is Memphis, yes. is the Beale Street Music Festival. For me, every year I get excited, like I want to go to this. It's only an hour from me. Uh-huh. And every year their lineup is just straight dog turds. Because this year, like, I mean, they've got guests I want to see, but not a lot. Not a lot of artists that I want to go out of my way. They just added Everclear, and I want to see Everclear live.
God, I didn't know Everclear was still around.
But I don't want to go and spend the 3-day ticket for $200 to go see Everclear.
Right, yeah.
So
that wouldn't be the smartest decision.
No, I've made some dumber ones. I feel you've got another one.
I do. And it's not at a festival, but it is a big tour. He announced, and I went all crazy fangirl when the original announcement came out. It was just like a short leg.
Our poor Facebook page on that day, because I just I wake up and there's 15 Rob Thomas posts. I'm like, what?
Yeah, I went a little Rob Thomas crazy. So they announced he's finally. I was hoping he was going to come to Chicago, and it's not quite Chicago. It's outside of Chicago. It's northern suburbs. He's coming to Ravinia Park in Highland Park, Illinois. If anyone's familiar with that. But yes, Rob Thomas is bringing his Chip 2 Smile tour, and I need to find a way to go. It's a little, if you're listening and you're from Chicago, Ravinia is not the easiest place to get to if you're near like the Midway Airport area like I am. It's probably if I leave from work, it's like a $30 Uber. And if I leave from where I live, it's like a $50 Uber ride. Well, just under like 48.
Holy crap.
Yeah, so you're looking at $100 just in transportation if I decide to Uber it, because I don't mess with the Metro train. So I might have to prepare for that. It's in June, so I kind of got to start thinking about that. But I'm super excited for this album, for his tour.
I've never seen anyone so excited about a concert announcement in my 34 years of life.
I finally got to see Rob Thomas two or three years ago. Solo. He opened for Counting Crows. Well, it was co-headlining, but he was he played before Counting Crows, which I disagreed with.
No, when you said that, my mind just kind of went into a state of baffled.
Yeah, I know. I didn't understand it either. We left before Counting Crows were even
over.
I like Counting Crows, yes. But live, it's a little weird. You know, Adam Duritz, he's a brilliant guy, but brilliant people, especially artists, they get weird and they change things up, you know, the arrangement of songs and stuff, and it doesn't always the delivery is not always great, and that was one of those cases where it wasn't. But Rob Thomas's set was phenomenal. I was so ecstatic I finally got to see him live. Just an amazing performer. I think he sweat through like 6 shirts, I counted. He's like he's 40 something years old. I mean, he's running from one end of the stage to the other. He's so, so talented. Everyone in his band, his backup singers, just incredible. Then the year after, I finally got to see Matchbox 20 live. And oh my God. I took my brother with me, and I think he was like, kind of like, I don't know if I'm going to enjoy it, whatever, you know.
And then
he was really surprised.
And then after it was over, he was a diehard fan.
Yeah, now like he goes back and he listens to their stuff and everything. And it's just, I mean, and he's, you know, you look around and it is, it's a lot of older people, you know, my age and a little bit older, some a little bit younger. But I mean,
we're the same age, right?
Who?
Me and you.
I think so. I'll be 34 in June.
Oh, I'm 34 now. Yeah, no, I'm older. Oh, okay. When you said there's older people, I go, well, it's us. It's our people. What are you talking about?
Yeah, there was a couple like slightly older than us, and then a lot of people our age and just slightly younger. But I mean, just one of the best live bands you'll see. One of my favorite live shows, and I'm not just saying that because I'm a huge fan of their music, but performance-wise, it was just incredible. So I'm really excited to see. Obviously, I've seen Rob Thomas before solo, like I said, but with this new album coming out, I'm so anxious to hear it. So I really like. I can't wait. I'm hoping I get to see him again.
That's going to be a fun show.
Yeah. And Amy Anderson, who we love, is opening for him.
Oh, right on.
Which I think it's amazing for him to bring out a female up-and-coming artist.
I'm all for this.
Yes.
I'm all for a new movement in music right now, because a lot of music is terrible.
Yeah. I'm all about supporting the female music. And that's not because... And I'm not trying to get all feminist on people and... I'm not trying to say that, like, just because they're a female, they deserve the attention or they deserve, you know, the credit or whatever. No, they deserve the equal opportunity that male artists are getting. That's all they're asking for.
Wait till you hear my influential artist stuff. Just wait.
You know, obviously, like, I believe people, no matter what your gender is or anything else that people think should play a factor, if you're not earning it based on merit, it doesn't mean anything, in my opinion. The problem with the female... artists is they're not getting the opportunity that the male artists are, and that's the problem. That's what people are fighting for. They just want the opportunity.
I can't believe we're still having these conversations in 2019.
I know, in 2019. It's ridiculous.
It is baffling. Does this mean it is time to move on to the big topic? Is that it?
It is.
Oh,
yes.
Boy. Oh, boy.
It's time for our feature segment. So this week's theme is our most influential albums. Basically, it's the albums that have impacted us the most. You know, for me personally, I grew up listening to 90s country and what we now call classic rock, as well as Motown, a little bit of disco. My mom's a huge disco person.
Time out. Why didn't you tell me that this show has a Instagram account until just now?
So it's actually I told you I have a website for like just where my work is.
Right.
And it's called Striking a Chord. I created the Instagram for that, like back when I created the website.
Gotcha.
And it just so happens, like now that with the podcast, like it works, I can like coincide it.
Oh, right on. Just wondering. Yeah. I was like, what? Wait, the show's following me? How does this work? What?
I can just picture like the look on your face right now.
I was very confused. Continue.
But yeah,
on.
So I mean, growing up, you know, I was surrounded by all different kinds of music. You know, my dad was 90s country and classic, what we call classic rock now. My mom was Motown and disco, but together they were the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and, you know, some classic rock, Styx and Chicago, Aerosmith, Boston, and the Beach Boys and, you know, Little Richard and Chuck Berry and, you know, all those, the Turtles, the Monkees, all those 50s and 60s bands. So a lot of that, definitely, like all of that played a factor. And like, I can still like cite a lot of that, like those songs and everything. Like I can, if I hear a song, like I can tell you, oh, that's the song my mom sang to us when we were kids. Like, you know, or that's the song I heard in a car with my dad or whatever, you know? But the albums on this list that we're getting ready to go into, for me, I don't know about you, how you chose yours, but I chose mine. These were the albums that spoke to me. Like as I got older in high school and then going into college, there was albums that came out that, oh God, I could tell you the first time I heard them, or I could tell you, you know, I may have not listened to them when they came out at the time, but as I go on later in life, like they went on to become like much more meaningful albums to me. So that's kind of how like I formed my list. I don't know how you decided to do yours.
Mine's all over the place. There's albums from the past that influenced me when I was younger. There are albums that influence me now as a content creator.
Mm-hmm.
Their album, yeah, it's everything in between.
Okay.
So I have a couple albums that are more modern.
Okay.
I have albums that are not that modern. So it really is everything and anything in between. And probably I'm going to get made fun of for a couple of my choices. I already know this.
We don't aim to make fun of. We
you say that now.
We have a friendly poker here, or a jab or so here and there.
I got nothing. So there's 10. We had this debate for what, 2 days to make this?
Yes.
Let's do 40. Let's what?
Well, mind you, it was 20 a piece.
Yeah, I couldn't even come up with 10.
Oh, God.
No, I got to 13.
It was so hard to come up with 10.
I got to 13 eventually. So in case we have one that's the same, I have backups.
Okay, yeah, I have runners up.
No, you're good. No, you've got honorable mentions. I really don't. I could tell you songs. Now, here's the thing. I could do songs all day long.
Yeah.
I couldn't do whole albums because I came, like at the time when I started really getting into music was the time that you could actually burn a disc and put whatever music you wanted on it.
So you never did the cassette tape?
I did, but there were very few that I owned.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Or I would record music off the radio so I could hear what I wanted.
Oh, I remember trying to do that. God, kids these days have no idea what the struggle was like.
Yeah, you and your iTunes. You confabbed kids and your iTunes.
And don't get me wrong, I love the convenience of, you know, Apple Music and streaming services and, you know, iTunes and everything. But, man, the struggle was real back in the day.
All right, who's going to go first here?
you're the guest. I'll let you go first.
Good. I'm going to pick one from my high school era.
Okay.
The year is 2003.
I forgot to put the years down on these.
Well, I just remember it because I got to write about it in my high school newspaper. I was pop culture editor of my high school newspaper.
Of course you were.
Yeah. And I would discover new music and I would decide to write about it and go, hey, this is this month's featured artist. And one of the months before they became a huge thing at the time, probably 3 months before, I got to see them live.
Okay.
At a venue that's now a church. And
interesting.
Yeah. It was a club for 18 and under. but they would always do huge music acts there. Mm-hmm. So anybody could come watch. And to this day, it's one of the only few albums that's completely on one of my, that's been on every playlist I've had since 2003.
I can't wait to hear this.
Fallen by Evanescence.
Okay. I never dug deep into Evanescence, but I did always like, you know, like their radio songs or other couple songs here and there.
I have an affinity for female-led rock bands. Mm-hmm. I don't know what it is, but when a, like, I get the appeal of rock music, having a guy in the front, being having the deep voice, but there is just something poetic about putting that hard rock sound with a woman who's able to do opera.
Yeah.
That's just un-frickin' believable. And my first introduction to that genre was Evanescence. Because it...
Yeah.
And when I first heard them live, I went, this is my new favorite band.
I remember when the first single came out for Bring Me to Life.
Which was on the Daredevil soundtrack.
Yes, exactly. Was it Daredevil or was it Punisher?
Daredevil.
It was Daredevil, yeah.
February of 2003. I can tell you when that soundtrack came out. Because I saw them in December.
Okay.
And they were opening for Crossfade. To let you know how old this is.
Holy crap, I forgot about Crossfade.
Yeah. So I got, she came out, they performed, her and Ben Moody, which he was no longer with the band after the first album.
Yeah.
Which tainted them later on. Like, I feel this is the album, if you want a definitive Evanescence sound, even though they still sound like Evanescence through their next couple of albums, they just haven't captured the magic that they did the first one.
No, they definitely didn't. The album with Call Me When You're Sober, I probably came close, but...
No, I mean, I like that album.
Yeah.
Good Enough is one of my favorite Evanescence songs, but there is just nothing that tops that first album.
Yeah, oof. I agree.
Oof. Bring Me to Life and... oh, crud. Now, see, I get put on the spot.
Oh, My Immortal.
That's the one I was thinking of. My Immortal with the guitar riff.
Yeah.
Is unbelievable, especially if you're having a bad day. And I remember listening to that song and crying it out. Yeah, no, I cried. And just bawled.
No shame.
No, and bawled, and I would feel better because that song was just so powerful.
Yeah.
I'd never heard anything like that song before then. Now after I have, but before that moment, right. No. That is one of the most influential albums to me.
Yeah, and there was bands that came, oh God, I don't know if they came out around the same time or after, but Within Temptation is another example.
Within Temptation.
Yeah. They have a couple songs that I like really, really love. And I actually got introduced to them because one of their songs was an episode, Do Not Judge. One of their songs was in an episode of The Vampire Diaries. And from there, I went exploring and I fell in love with another one of their songs because of the title was what caught my attention. But then I listened to the song and it was just really, really good. And then turned out at the time, one of my friends was actually, this guy was really into bands like Within Temptation and Evanescence, you know, bands with who were rock, but they had that female front, female singer who had that like opera like voice.
Yes.
So it just opened a whole bunch of doors.
So my first one, not that bad.
No, not at all.
That will change.
All right, let me see who I want to start with. I'm not going in any kind of order at all.
I could, but I don't want to.
So I guess we'll start with a band who's one of my favorites, the Goo Goo Dolls. The album, do you want to guess what album I put as one of my most influential?
There's two that I could guess right off the top of my head.
Okay.
But I've got to remember which one's what, because... I want to say there come a time in my life frame that I would get Goo Goo Dolls and Matchbox 20 albums titles mixed up.
Really?
Not that I didn't know, like I knew their songs, but I would get the titles mixed up. So I've got to look this up really fast so I don't sound like an idiot because I don't want that crap coming back on me because I know all of you listening, you will send me hate mail.
Oh, the hate mail.
No, I'm just going to say it's Dizzy Up the Girl.
It's not. So I love that album. It's an iconic album. But the album that it was one of the, this is one of the albums that came after Dizzy Up the Girl. And It's Gutterflower.
That was my second choice. Yeah, that was my second one.
And the reason this album stuck out for me personally was because the lyrics to some of the songs, specifically Here Is Gone, is to this day one of my all-time favorite songs. It came out at a time when, oh god, and this song still haunts me. Every time I hear it on the radio, I can sing along to every single word at the top of my lungs. And it still takes me back to a time when, you know, you're going through bad relationships, you know, on and off again relationships and stuff, and it just reminds you of that person or that relationship or that time in your life when the lyrics just were your life at that moment. And I mean, I've said this before, Johnny Resnick is one of the best singers and songwriters music will ever see. He's so talented. And this album, I mean, there's not a bad song on this album. And I think it only had 1, 2, 3 big radio singles. But if you listen to the whole album, I went back and listened to it from front to back today. And I was just reminded of like how great of an album it was, because it's a great combination of like their early 90s stuff, which was phenomenal, and like their later like pop stuff. It does a great job of mixing the two, and it's just, oh god, I could listen to the Goo Goo Dolls for days.
It's a great choice. I can't even like that. Here Is Now. Oh man. Now it's like both of our albums came out in 2002, or Here Is Gone. Both of our albums came out in 2002. That's crazy to me. How does that work?
The early 2000s was such a great year.
A
great decade, I should say.
I refer to that as one of the most underrated times, because you're coming off the 90s, which was great, but there was so much angst. And then here comes the 2000s. And that early 2000s run, other than the Thong Song, was so good.
Yeah, I agree.
Oh, geez. Oh, geez. You know what? I'm going to pull one from the retro.
Okay.
I have very few albums that are autographed. I have very few vinyls. Let's go there.
Oh god, vinyl is totally another episode.
I love 80s music.
Yeah.
With a passion. Like, it's almost an obsession. I enjoy cheesy 80s synth pop.
Are we talking like Aha type?
We are. We 80s? Are.
Okay.
There is one band in particular, though, from the day I started doing any sort of entertainment, the day I started doing radio and everything, this band has somehow ended up in everything I've done.
Uh-oh.
And I had to go out of my way, and I love the entire album because, but it's not like, it's not, I'll just say this, it's not going to be inspirational music, but it's just music you can put on and be, just realize how great life is.
Yeah, and that's important. That's important to have that kind of music.
And ironically enough, it is Freeze Frame by the Jay Giles Band.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. Because for some reason, Centerfold and Freeze Frame have ended up in everything I have done.
So, funny story about the Jay Giles Band for me.
Oh, jeez.
I had a boyfriend in high school who, for whatever reason, loved that song, Centerfold. And I mean, it's a catchy song, don't get me wrong.
It's very catchy.
That's how I got introduced to the Jay Giles Band, was a high school boyfriend would play that song. And it somewhere ended up on one of my mix CDs at that time. But yeah, it was, god. And whenever I hear that song, it's like, that's immediately where my mind goes, is high school.
I just automatically, every time I hear Freeze Frame, I start dancing. I don't care where I am. It will just happen.
You're in the grocery store.
Yeah, no, it's happened like numerous times for me. That album just like, and there are songs on there that are a little bit more emotional, but it's just such a good album where like inspirational can mean so many different things. For this, for me, this album was, this is for me to let go and be silly. Mm-hmm. And I feel this, like, that 80s sound was able to bring that side of me out.
Yeah.
And that album alone, because when you tell people, you know, I have the Jay Giles Freeze Frame album, and they're just kind of like, what? And it's autographed. What?
That's awesome.
Yeah. So, that's one for me.
Okay. So, I guess next on my list, I'll go with a rock band who...
It's Nickelback.
No. Oh, no. So on my list, I have... So the band is Trapped.
What?
Don't judge. Hang on. So I have two albums on here. They're self-titled, and then their album from 2005, Only Through the Pain. But I'd have to say, like, self-titled obviously is what got everyone, was what introduced everyone to Trapped. And say what you will about them, that album is awesome.
No, I'm not going to say that's any, it's not bad. It's just one of those, I'm like, what did you just, did you say Trapped? Hold on.
Yeah.
Trapped?
I love me some Trapped. I'm not going to lie. I could listen to most, up until their later albums, I could listen to most of their catalog and not skip a song. But the album on my most influential list is, like I said, it came out in 2005. It's Only Through the Pain. And this is the one with Who's Going Home With You Tonight, Contagious, Ready When You Are, Forget About the Rain, Cover Up, Only One in Cover, Wasteland. It's just, you know, again, it's one of those albums where at a time in my life, I believe it was like right after college, stuff that was going on, like, you know, relationship-wise and stuff, the songs on here just spoke to me. They ended up on so many of my mix CDs that no one else but me heard. One of my girlfriends. It's just the lyrics. I'm very much like a lyric-based person. And you hear these songs, and it was like they were speaking to me. Like, they were writing about my life at that time. And, I mean, the music itself is good. Like, it wasn't, like, too hardcore rock, but it was, like, just rock enough. Like, it wasn't soft rock, you know?
It towed a very fine line at that time.
Yeah, and oh god, I can't even describe it properly, but the lead singer, god, I should know his name off the top of my head, I don't, but he really has a great voice, and I think Trapped became very underrated.
Are they still making music by chance, just out of curiosity?
I think so. Their last album, let me look and see when it came out. I think they did put an album out not too long ago. It wasn't great. Like, it's nothing's going to beat, like, their first few albums. Yeah, they put one, they put an album out in, oh, hang on, this thing doesn't go in order.
Of course it doesn't. I would.
Oh, wait, here it is. So they put out DNA in 2016.
That's was relatively new, though.
Yeah, it wasn't great. No Apologies was in 2010. That one was okay. And then in 2008, why does this say 2008 here? Was Only Through the Pain.
So what you're telling me is they probably had 2-3 albums at the most that are really worth it?
So their first album... see, this is weird. Hang on.
I have 2008 for Only the Pain as well.
Okay. So their first album came out in 2002. That was the self-titled album with Hedgehog, Made of Glass, Hollow Man, These Walls, Echo, Still Frame. When All Said
and Done, an great amazing song album. Too.
That came out in, what did I just say? 2002. Yeah. Another, again, a great year
for music. 2002 is just...
Their second full-length album came out in 2005, Someone in Control. Again, good album, but then Only Through the Pain came out in 2008, and that album is really what spoke to me, I guess. After that, like I said, No Apologies and DNA, it starts to die down, and they kind of lose their momentum.
But at least they're still making music. I enjoyed Trapped for what it were, like, for a period of time, because I mean those songs are always going to be on my playlist.
Yeah, for sure. Wow. Yeah, I mean they're still one of my favorite rock bands.
I just kind of caught me off guard.
Good, I'm glad I can keep you on your toes.
Oh, I'm gonna here we go. let's see, do I just give a normal one this time, because I hit with Jay Giles Band and everybody's going,
you can do whatever you want.
Look, the year is 1997.
Okay. Oh, this could be any number of things.
I think it's 1997. Let me make sure of the year. I know it's in that time
frame. Jagged Little Pill.
No, but that is actually on my list in case you actually say something that I have.
Okay.
That's an honorable mention for me.
Okay. I'm surprised it's not like number one.
No, my number one's just weird. The year is 1997. I remember going with my best friend from high school.
Okay.
Or not my best friend at this time, junior high. and us going to a theme park in Kansas City and it raining all day long. But I knew I was having the time of my life, and hint, wink, wink, nudge, nudge. That look, it's Nimrod. That's such a wonderful album.
Yeah.
I still to this day believe that Nimrod might be my favorite Green Day album.
And yeah, I mean, for me, it's definitely Nimrod or Dookie.
There's so many fun songs on Nimrod, besides the ones that everyone heard on the radio.
Right.
Because Good Riddance, Time of Your Life, still, that's an anthem. When you're going through that time frame in middle school, I remember our graduation, our senior slideshow, that was the end song. When they did all this, like going, really? Wow, this song comes full circle. All the time for me, because every time I get into a situation where it's just amazing, somehow.
And wasn't the song written like about a stripper or something like that?
Yeah, it's.
And yet it was used for so many graduations. Like it's really funny.
Everyone has that in their graduate. That and that Vitamin C song. Everyone had those. But Nimrod's.
There was also an Eve 6 song too. Here's to the Nights.
I love that song. Love Eve 6. But that whole album, and I found songs on that later on. Queen for a Day still cracks me up.
King for a Day.
Yeah, King for a Day is probably one of my favorite. That's probably, honest to God, that, and there's another one that's by Blink-182 that falls in that same category that will always end up being on my playlist. Or Brass Monkey will always be on my playlist by the Beastie Boys, just because they're just so much fun to listen to.
Yeah. But
this was in that.
They just like get you going.
Yeah. This was that album that was so much fun to listen to and yet would hit you right in the feels with the next song, which is what Green Day got really known for.
Yeah.
Because now, I mean, the American Idiot album is a musical.
Yeah, which is crazy.
And they're still making music. They're still fun to go see. They're still fun just in general. That to me, like for that entire junior high frame of life, that's probably the album that's like, that's what 13-year-old Richard's like right there.
So funny enough, in my freshman year of high school, I had a friend who was obsessed with Blink-182. Like, obsessed. Why am I talking about Blink-182? Green Day. I'm sorry. She was obsessed with Blink-182 too, but Green Day. And that's kind of how I got into them. The album, though, like, obviously, like, I went back like any true like music fan and listened to all the great albums. But the album at the time that really, like, in kind of like, I don't want to say introduced me, but started my my wheels rolling on the Green Day train was, and I'm probably going to get some flack for this from hardcore Green Day fans, was Warning.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
There's like, I think I'm hearing crickets.
Well, I didn't expect that.
I mean, it's not on my list, but since you were talking about Green Day, that's the album that, like, started, like I said, like, got me going on Green Day. And then I went back and listened to older albums like Nimrod and Dookie, and I mean, those are not, like, my favorite albums. But Green Day is what got me started.
That's an album Warning. That no one talks about.
And I know. And, like, I remember seeing a music video for the song. It was, like, a parade. I can't think of the name of the song. But I mean, that's what got me going.
Would it be Macy's Day Parade? Because that's a song on it.
Oh God, it might be. I think it was. I remember seeing the video, and I remember like people in like chat rooms at the time were like talking like mad smack about Green Day and that album and that song. And I'm like, why are you hating people? Like, why are you hating on them? Like, because I was just starting to get like to really dive into them. And I don't know. I enjoyed Warning. Church on Sunday is still like an awesome jam.
I completely agree. That's a, you know, it's a very now that album's underrated.
Yes, very much so.
Still Green, yeah. So we talked Green Day. So yay, I got Green Day in this conversation. I still don't look like a fool too much yet.
So going along those same lines, and since I already brought up Blink-182, they are on my list.
Oh, of course,
influential albums.
I love Blink.
Oh God, and Dude Ranch is a great album. Enema of the State, great album. I love all their older stuff. There's songs that really stick out. But, again, as far as albums that came out at a time when I really needed it, an album that really got me rolling. Take Off Your Pants and Jacket is still one of my favorite albums.
I love the name of Blink 182 albums and some of their songs. Just
yeah, right.
Just makes me happy inside just to say things that nobody else would say, because I can say one of the songs that will always be on my playlist, but we're trying to stay away from the F word.
Yeah. this album, when they toured for this album, this was the first time I saw Blink 182, one of my other favorite bands, especially in the pop punk genre, opened for them. And so, I mean, it was just such an amazing experience getting to go see them. But this album, I mean, I remember putting it on a mix CD with like other pop punk bands and playing it in a car at night, like with some friends who also enjoyed the music. And we were being, you know, we were out later than we were supposed to be, and we just didn't care. And we had these songs like blasting through the car radio, car stereo. And I mean, you know, songs like The Rock Show, like that song is never going to get old. It's never going to get old. Anthem Part 2, you know, First Date, online songs. And then, you know, you got your more serious songs, you know, Stay Together for the Kids. But I mean, God, there's not a bad song on this album.
Blink 182 is one of those bands, no matter how old I'm going to get, I'm probably always going to be a fan of.
Yes, absolutely.
Because every time, because I mean, they are that, they're the ones who really started that punk genre to me. Like, I mean, them and the Green, pop-punk genre, yeah, because yeah. I mean, Green Day, yes, yeah, so they've been around forever. Mm-hmm. But there's just, I like to refer to it as the warp sound.
Yes, absolutely.
Because they were kind of, I know Green Day was too, but there's just a bunch of bands that just kind of all hit at the same time. Because mm-hmm. even though Green Day was popular, I do believe Nimrod's what really set them into a different stratosphere.
Yeah.
And Blink 182 came out, what, 99? The Enema of the State album came out in 99, right?
Yes.
Same principle. I remember when that album came out. And yeah. I went, I need all these songs, and I need those now.
Yep. And I loved Enema of the State, but it was less relatable lyrically. Whereas Take Off Your Pants and Jacket...
Oh, this that came song out
when
is
I was still
the...
in high school.
Damn it, the
2001.
Song... Sorry, I just found out that song that I was thinking of is on this album.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, Happy Holidays.
Is that it?
Happy Holidays, you bastard.
Nope. Oh, wait, maybe. What is the name of that damn song? Hold on, give me a second. Keep talking. I got this.
Okay. I mean, this song. So the album came out in 2001. I was still in high school. It was my sophomore year. Going into junior year, this was like the epitome of pop punk at that time. Just the lyrics were just so much more relatable than anything on Enema of the State. Not to take away from Enema of the State, but I mean, you know, like again, going back to like First Date and, you know, Roller Coaster and The Rock Show, this was like the life you were living if you were in high school at that time and a pop punk fan. Truth. You know, you were going to Warped Tour and you were meeting people, you know, and just going through that angst of, you know, teenage dating and all that. And
so true.
It was like the soundtrack to my high school life.
If you want me to bleep the F word, I will, but I think you know what song I'm talking about.
Okay, you're going to have to tell me.
All right, well, I'm just going to say it and I apologize, but Fuck a Dog?
That is not on this album.
Yeah, it is.
I forgot about that song. No, it's not.
Yeah, it's on the yellow.
Oh, is it like a bonus version?
Yeah, it's on the, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that's why. Okay.
Yeah. That, because I was like, I thought it was on this album, and then I never saw, I was just looking at the track list and go, wait. And then it listed all the bonus stuff. That song is funny.
Yeah.
Because if you're in a car that's unsuspecting of what you have on your playlist and you start playing that, you're going to have a conversation for the rest of the car ride.
Yeah, for sure.
Oh, boy.
Your turn.
Yay. Not that I'm not like impressed by this, but I really do enjoy a bunch of albums, and this was really, or a bunch of songs, but putting together looking for albums that weren't compilations. Let me rephrase that.
Yeah.
Because I had a ton of those back when I was growing up that I'm like, hey, I love that compilation. Like the Beatles one.
Mm-hmm.
Budgen loved the Beatles one album.
Yeah.
But that's just a bunch of number ones.
Right, exactly.
Like that's kind of a letdown. Okay.
Kind of like Garth Double Live.
Yeah. So
in the 90s.
So again, you can tell what my listen to is. Like, I didn't incorporate any Scott. Well, I did, but it's not who you think. But okay. I love songs that are, I love bands who are upbeat because
yeah.
that's who I am as a person. I'm more of an upbeat. I try to be anyway. Like, I have right. my days.
Yeah, we all do.
But there was one album. 1996.
Ooh.
Yeah, I think it's 96. And a certain song that became a karaoke anthem.
Oh, boy.
If you are able to talk really, really... You got to be kidding me. If you're able to talk really, really fast.
I don't know why I'm going to say this. I'm probably going to be totally off, but Bare Naked Ladies?
Stunt. 100% that album will always... Like, I love that album.
Wait, I'm right?
Yeah, it's Bare Naked Ladies. It's Stunt by the Bare Naked Ladies, yeah.
Oh, my God. Because as soon as you said if you could talk fast, the first thing I immediately thought of was... Oh, God, something with the Chinese chicken.
Yeah, that's it. That's it.
That's awesome.
I love this album.
I love your enthusiasm.
Yeah. Please. Well, I mean, of course, 1 week, because that is right. my go-to karaoke song.
Oh, my God. If you ever come to Chicago, we're doing karaoke, and you have to sing that song.
I always need to watch this. I do that and Wannabe by the Spice Girls constantly. Nice. I love that song. Alcohol is a fun, like, it's a little sad, but also fun. I'll Be That Girl, fun song. There's just so many great songs on this album. There's one about meeting someone while playing The Price is Right. So much fun. I mean, they're one of those bands, which they're on tour with Hootie this year.
Yes.
They're on my bucket list because I've never got to see them live yet. Because they are absolutely one of my all-time favorite bands. Because when 1 week came out, I went, this is the greatest song.
I remember seeing that in, was it 10 Things I Hate About You, right?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, I think so too.
But yeah, every time that song comes on, I feel nostalgia. Just every time. I hear you. And it kind of changes. Since I've gotten older, I went, oh, these albums are even better.
You know what's a really, really great song by Bare Naked Ladies, and it's newer. I think it maybe have came out like within the last couple years. I didn't really appreciate it though until I heard one of the song Suffragettes cover it. Kaylee Shore is Odds Are.
I have heard
it's
that.
It's such a great song.
They are very underrated songwriters.
Yeah,
and I know a lot of people are gonna. I think they're always gonna be. Hey, they're either the band that did 1 week or the band that sings the. Big Bang Theory sound song. That's it. That's all anyone's going to see them as.
Yeah. But
they are nerdcore to the finest.
I like me some Bare Naked Ladies. I'm not going to lie.
There's something that my list is very happy. I don't know if you figured this out yet.
I'm glad that your list is happy.
Until I play, say one of my albums and everybody's going to be like, oh.
Although, I mean, Evanescence wasn't really like...
Evanescence isn't a happy one. Happy. Yeah, no, I think I'm gonna start with a sad one and then end with a sad one. Like, I'm just going to put a bunch of happy in the middle.
So my next one is... Oh, God. These guys changed hard rock in the
Nickelback.
2000s.
Nickelback.
No, Nickelback's not on my list.
It's going to be Nickelback.
Sadly, their singer is no longer with us.
Well, this is Linkin Park.
Yes, it is. And people can love or hate Linkin Park, but there's no denying like what they did for the alternative rock, hard rock genre. Their debut album, Hybrid Theory, came out in 2000. And, oh, God, you go back and listen to this album because you, like, almost forget how good it is. You go back and you listen to the lyrics, right, especially on this album, and... God, it's almost like not really a surprise, I guess. And I don't mean that in a bad way, but like, it's almost not a surprise that Chester took his own life because, I mean, you listen to the lyrics in this song, these songs, and I mean, he's speaking to like our inner struggles, like everyone goes through. I mean, Hybrid Theory alone, Paper Cut, One Step Closer, With You, Points of Authority, Crawling. You really dig deep into the lyrics and it's like, wow, this guy was really going through some shit. You know what I mean? Like,
you know, if those songs would have came out to now, we probably would have been look at them much differently than we did when they came out in 2000.
Yeah, and we just didn't take mental health seriously then.
Because there are three artists at that time. It was Linkin Park, Limp Bizkit, and Kid Rock, which just kind of weirdly, you were a fan of one of the three.
Right.
And when Linkin Park came out, I kind of just dropped the other two because I went, this is the sound.
Yeah, exactly.
Because there was so much raw emotion that you just could not get from a Kid Rock song or a Limp Bizkit song.
Right. And I remember like when One Step Closer came out, and I remember seeing the video for this. And again, it was back in the MTV days. Ooh. And it was just like, oh man, again, you were having a bad day. You were pissed off or angry at the world, or you just wanted to tell people to leave you the F alone. That was the song that you blasted. Like, that was the song you turned up. You know, and then songs like, you know, In the End. Oh, again, a song when I was in high school and, you know, you were dealing with a breakup or, you know, an ex-boyfriend that's trying to come back in your life. Like, this was the song that, like, you turned up in the car with your girlfriend. Like, all these songs, like Runaway and Crawling. I mean, oh, A Place for My Head. It's just, God, I can't even imagine what Chester was going through when he wrote these songs. And it's sad that he's not with us anymore. It changes.
It's heartbreaking. It changes every song. It's almost like going back and listening to Nirvana and knowing what you know now, where it completely changes everything that was written in each song. And that's how I feel about Linkin Park. Like, now the music is even more I don't know the word I'm trying to find. It's even more dynamic than it was than when it came out.
Right.
And that's crazy.
It is. And like, the songs still hold up. Like, I was listening to this the other day at work, and I'm like, man, like, I still feel these same emotions. You know what I mean? Like, maybe not like every day, but like, you know, again, like, you're having a bad day, or like, you're going through some shit. Like, this is the album to listen to. Like, and because it's not depressing, you know, as far as like, it's not gonna like bring you down, you know, but it's not like happy, but it's still like, it covers all your emotions. Like, it's just, it's heavy in, you know, the lyrical sense and the music sense, without being too heavy. And oh, it's just such a great album. It still holds up today. And this album, this band changed hard rock. They inspired so much of the sound that we hear today, of this like rap rock. And I don't mean that like a Kid Rock kind of rap rock.
No,
I mean,
this is like true rap rock.
Exactly. I mean, they just, I can't even say like how influential Linkin Park is in music.
I think I'm going to go completely opposite of you, because I feel like I got to bring up the mood a little, because I was going to say one of my rock albums and I went, I just can't keep the depression going.
I'm sorry.
No, that's such, like, look, like, I never really put into context how emotionally pivotal that album now is.
Right.
Where back in the day, when you're listening to that in 2000 and you're listening to In the End and just thinking, this is a really good anthem, but it's just a great, it's just a song and that's it. No, yep. Now it's more than that.
Yeah, definitely.
In Utero from Nirvana almost made my list, by the way. Came very close. Yeah, I love that album.
Huh.
But I discovered it more as an adult than I did when I was... Okay, so that's a... Okay. I think that we're not going to dive very much into this, but because I feel during my time in radio, which was 2005 to 2009...
Okay.
I got to talk to a certain artist that was just coming up into the ranks of country music at that time. Mm-hmm. And I went, you know what? I'm going to follow your career. And I did. And to this day, they are probably one of my favorite artists of all time. But it was also one of the first albums I ever gave away on radio.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. And I think it's 2007 or 2008. It's later in my run, but it was one of the first albums that we ever had. Like, we get promotional stuff all the time at the radio station. I think you understand this, but we never got more than five. We got like two boxes of stuff where I went, oh, this is great. Cause I got to do a whole bunch of stuff with Taylor Swift's Fearless that I never thought I would ever get to do. And that's one of my favorite albums of all time.
Yes.
I don't know how much we're going to spend on it, but there we go.
Wait, so is that on your list?
Yeah.
She's on, that album is on my list.
Aha! We have one.
And I mean, everyone knows this by now. Me and you are both huge Taylor Swift fans. I love every album she does. But this was the album that, again, it's about the lyrics. It's about the emotion and where you were in your life when you heard these lyrics. At least that's how I took it. Like, there's not, she doesn't have any bad songs, but this album, just song for song, was
her phenomenal. First album was really good. This is the album that put her on the map.
Yes.
Like, that's how I like, because most of the time the sophomore album sucks.
Usually it doesn't live up to the first.
This one, very rare, even in movies, the sequel is Fearless better.
Exceeded her debut album.
Yeah, because her third album, not as good as this one. And that's kind of what, like, the one, I think it's the one with Mean. Sparks Fly?
See, I love that album.
I do too, but it's not as good as this one. We might debate there. But, yeah. But like, as far as, but she keeps progressing, and she keeps trying new things, and that's more than I can say for some artists, hint Metallica.
Yes.
And,
yes.
I just had Metallica and Taylor Swift in the same sentence. Oh, boy. But this album actually was one of those things in radio where I went, this album makes me happy. And it's radio to me. When I think back of my time and I look back at a good time in my life when I was doing that, this is the album.
See, and it's so funny, interesting that you see this at, like, you hear this album and you think of a happy time in your life.
Yeah.
I hear this album and I think of a lot of heartbreak. You know what I mean? Like, when I heard this album, like, that's what I was going through at that time, was a lot of heartbreak.
So I've got it. There's a girl I was really into.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's this album, when a certain song came out, and I tried because I went, okay, I hope to God this doesn't exist. Somewhere out there, there's probably a lip sync video of this, of Love Story.
Okay.
And no, You Belong With Me. You Belong With Me. I tried. I failed. We didn't go on a date though. But that was her ringtone. Yeah, that was her ringtone. It was all that. Aww. I mean, I'm much happier now. Like, I won the lottery. But still, 2008 Richard was, or 2009 Richard was just kind of like, yeah.
That was your version of John Cusack's
Say Anything?
Holding up the
boombox. Oh, yeah. No, it was. Because I did this because we went to see Love and Theft and Jason Aldean.
Nice.
For our date, and went to Dave and Buster's, and it was just... But I would try to sneak in the Taylor Swift album anytime I could so she could hear the song. Oh, my God.
I love this story so much.
I make a fool of myself on every show I've done now.
But that's what makes you you, and we love you.
Well, I don't know about with love, but tolerable. No, I mean, that album, that's what... So there's the radio thing, but then there's also the other stuff. But the You Belong With Me video has probably been my second favorite Taylor Swift music video ever.
I mean, she's just unapologetically herself. I mean, she's what inspires young girls to be themselves, like to be them and not have to feel like they have to hide behind all this like pounds and pounds of makeup and slutty clothes and... Oh, God.
I just gift an image from that music video to a drag queen from RuPaul's Drag Race because she was like, why is Christmas movies in my trending on Netflix? And I said, I'm completely sorry, but it's probably our fault.
Oh, God. You know, people can hate on Taylor Swift all they want, but there is no better role model for your young daughter than Taylor Swift. I'm sorry.
No. I was going to try to think of an argument, but nope.
There's just not. I mean... You know, people can argue, you know, she jumps from relationship to relationship. She's in them for at least a few months, okay?
And, I was going to say, didn't everybody kind of jump from relationship to relationship in their 20s?
Right, exactly. And people want to argue, like, well, all she writes about is, you know, relationships and heartbreak and guys. Well, you're a musician.
And how much she hates.
What else are you going to friggin' write about?
And how much she hates Kanye West.
Yeah, right? Oh, God, that moment. That MTV Music Awards moment.
I was watching that live. That was one of the few times I was on radio doing that.
Really?
We were doing something with the VMAs, and it was, hey, do you want to come cover the VMAs for the radio station? I went, why? Number one. And so we'd be playing music and then talking about it after every, like, so often, and that happened, and we cut out a song and went, this is the craziest moment in the history of music.
I mean, she wins, which is amazing, and she's giving her speech, and then this freaking asshat comes out and just, oh, I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt you.
The Beyonce video is really good, though.
I, you know, it was for single, all the single ladies, right?
I think that's the one he was arguing? I think so.
See, I just...
Because it was with... I think it was against You Belong With Me.
Yeah. But the Beyonce video I'm talking about, the one that he was arguing was All the Single Ladies.
I think so. I think it was Single
Yeah. Ladies. See, I didn't care for that song. I'm not a Beyonce fan. I'm not arguing that she's vocally talented or that she can dance her ass off. I'm not arguing that because she can. I'm just not a fan of her or her music. And I'm sorry, like... First of all, if someone's going to argue on her behalf, shouldn't it be her husband? What the hell are you doing up there, Kanye, like, arguing on her behalf? Like, what is wrong with you?
I will say this. I do enjoy the music video. I'm trying to find out what the video was. Like, what was it? Oh, Single Ladies. All right, yeah. We're good. I want to know what else was up for that video. Oh, you know what?
I don't know.
I'm going to find that out.
But that was one of the last, like... VMA award shows where music was still like music. You know what I mean? Now nobody knows what the hell's up going on up there.
I tried watching a new VMAs. Like, I remember watching one and falling asleep.
Yeah, same. It's just not the same as it used to be.
So,
and that, again, that's a whole nother rabbit hole we can go down.
So here we go. That was up for Taylor Swift won Best Female Video.
Mm-hmm.
That's when it happened. It was up against Beyonce's Single Ladies.
Mm-hmm.
Kelly Clarkson's My Life Would Suck Without You.
Oh, good song.
Lady Gaga, Poker Face.
Wow.
Pink, So What.
Ugh.
And Katy Perry, Hot and Cold.
Damn.
Those are like some of the best music videos in all of music.
Yeah, agreed. Some of the best songs in all of music, not to mention some of the best songs just by females alone.
Hot and Cold is probably one of my favorite Katy Perry videos.
I remember when that song came out. Oh, God.
I still quote that song in everyday life.
Because again, it's all about the lyrics. Like, it may seem cheesy, but I mean, that's just the shit that you relate to.
So it's kind of funny that our number five album was the same, like, yeah, our fifth one that we've listed. So I guess, is it go back to me now, since, or do you do it? Is it your turn? Like, how are we doing this one?
I don't know. I guess I could do one.
Yeah, go ahead. This is number six. We're now okay. Moving forward. Yeah.
So I'll go with, oh God. Okay. So one of my, and I briefly mentioned them earlier when I was talking about Blink-182, one of my favorite bands,
Nickelback.
pop punk genre. It's hard to pick the album though, because so the band is Newfound Glory.
Holy crap.
I friggin' love them.
Holy crap.
They are one of my favorite bands. So the self-titled album came out in 2000, and that album, oh God, I mean, I could still, to this day, sing you word for word every song on that album. But their Sticks and Stones album, which came out 2 years later, is what really put them on the map, and that's what you started hearing on Q101. Well, so in Chicago, back when there were the Rock's alternative station, it was Q101. And those were the songs that you started hearing on that station. You know, My Friends Over You, which is probably not even the best song on the album. But again, it's one of those albums. I could sing you lyric for lyric every song on that album. And both albums, they came out at a time, again, when I was in high school, sophomore, junior year. And these were the songs that, like, summed up my, you know, my high school summers. Again, going to Warped Tour, going to concerts. Just, God, I lived for the pop punk genre when I was in high school and, you know, in early college. And Newfound Glory was a huge, huge part of that. And so it's kind of a tie for me with their self-titled album and the Sticks and Stones, because I can't pick between the two. It's like picking between, you know, your favorite child.
It's always the second one. sorry, parents, if you have two kids. Huh. I didn't expect that one.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh boy, I am going to, well, here we go. I'm just going to blow myself. There we go.
Oh boy.
I'm just going to blow myself up right now. Here we go. All right, here we go. I know that this is going to get some hate, and I'm fine with it because I love this album and it kind of defines who I am.
Mm-hmm.
So we go back to 1996.
Oh boy.
Oh boy. I just got my first CD player.
And what's the CD that you're jamming?
Yeah, no. So I had to get a CD for said CD player, and my mom, this is not the actual album, but my mom ordered a knockoff Macarena CD. It's not that one, but I went, all right, well, I guess that's okay. That had a lot of Santana music on it.
Okay.
They it was a knockoff. You know how they, you know those one albums where it's just a knockoff band will do all the popular music of today?
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like Kidz Bop, but just a little worse.
Okay.
Same principle.
Yeah.
All right. So I decide I need an album. And at that time, a certain group from Britain had just come out.
Oh, from Britain.
From Britain. And I needed the album. It was the, I was like, this is going to be an epic purchase. I need to make this really awesome. Am I going to get Nirvana? Nope. Am I going to get whatever else is out at the time? Chumbawamba? Nope. Because I think that was out at the time. No, I chose the Spice Girls Spice.
Oh, wow.
And I want you to know something. I'm not the only one in my friend circle who's male, who that was their first CD.
Really?
Yeah. That album, let me just say this. I didn't really get on the boy band craze, but I sure as hell got into the girl power phase during that time frame.
Oh, God. I remember my brother's friends, the who were all girls, they loved the shit out of the Spice Girls.
Who didn't love the shit out of the Spice Girls?
I didn't. I wasn't really crazy about the Spice Girls. I'm not going to lie to you.
That's not cool.
I'm sorry.
No, I absolutely think this is one of the best albums maybe I've ever owned. In fact, I still listen to this album to this day. Yeah, no, I still listen to this album to this day. Because when I, it takes, again, it's that nostalgia. It takes you back to a better time frame kind of deal. I know. I'm weird. It's cool. It's cool.
But I'm trying not to judge.
No, you're fine. I told you, you're going to laugh at me 100% because I know the next album I choose is going to be laughed at. But again, I have reasons. It was the first CD I ever owned. When I first started doing stand-up, I would use some of the music that wasn't released on radio in my house music.
Uh-huh.
So I would always pick songs that would get me into a really happy mood. And again, that was... You know what's weird? I don't know if I chose any of the albums that helped me through breakups because I don't... I only remember songs ever helping me through that those time frames, except mm-hmm. one album helped me through a breakup. One.
And what was that?
That's actually on my list. So oh, I can't... Okay. I can't really talk about that just yet. But yeah, Spice Girls Spice.
Wow.
Yep.
I don't think I saw that one coming.
Thank you.
Like, part of me is not surprised because I know you, but then part of me is still surprised. Like, you're always keeping me on my toes.
That's kind of what I do to everybody.
So I'm going to bring it down a couple notches.
Nickelback. No. I'm
kidding. No. What is your obsession with Nickelback?
I don't know. They're on your list, aren't they? No, I almost put that album. I almost put the first one because Silver Side Up.
Cause Silver Side Up, yeah.
It's a good album. I'm sorry.
It is.
But
so no, on my list, going back to the hard rock genre, a band who made their debut in 2003 with their self-titled album. And they're still on tour. They don't have the same lead singer, unfortunately, but they're still on tour. They just opened for Disturbed a couple weeks ago when I saw them. And it's 3 Days Grace.
Holy crap.
If you don't know just by the first couple chords of I Hate Everything About You, if you don't know that song and start singing and get excited, we can't be friends. Like, I mean, that song was massive. They brought hard rock to the masses, like, in a big way. And there, again, song for song on that album, there is not a bad song.
Wow. Not that I'm not. That I, you want to know something sad? I completely forgot about them.
I mean, and I think a lot of people did. But man, if they didn't have some just badass songs, I'm sorry. Like, again, lyrically, you could relate to them. Musically, it was heavy, but not like crazy, like metalcore heavy. Like, it was just perfect. And it was one of those things where, like, even if you weren't a hard rock fan, this brought out kind of like how the Black Album from Metallica brought out like the mainstream fan. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, people who were
listening to Britney Spears suddenly were listening to Metallica Black Album. People who were listening to, the Spice Girls or whatever, or whoever. If they were listening to, like, let's say, you know, Michelle Branch, they were also listening. And I love Michelle Branch. But, you know, they were also listening to 3 Days Grace. You know, people who listen to Nelly were listening to 3 Days Grace. Like, it was just, they were one of those bands that brought hard rock to the masses.
And they're still going, which is awesome.
Yeah, exactly.
I know I'm seeing them later this year. Not with Disturbed, but I'm seeing them later this year. I completely forgot about them.
Yeah, this album was huge. I mean, you'd get mad, you'd... You know, have a, again, going back to having a bad day. I mean, this was the album you just blasted.
3 Days Grace.
You weren't having a bad day.
3 Days Grace, Theory of a Dead Man, Seether. I had this like Seether. Pissed off album where I would, Bitch Came Back is still probably. I want you to know that was some people I know's ringtone that I'm friends with now. I'm not going to say who, because they're probably listening. But yeah, I love the rock genre. I know I haven't put that many rock albums in my playlist, but it's a significant time frame in my life, but it's songs. It's never.
Yeah. And see, and that's why like a lot of these albums on my list are from like that, like high school, college era, because that's when I really, really dug deep into music. And that's that. I mean, if without these albums, like without that time in my life, you wouldn't have this Amanda right here. Who's obsessive, you know, and passionate about music. Like, these are the albums that did it for me.
So I said I have a lot of females on my list, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've named the Spice Girls.
Yeah.
I've named Taylor Swift.
Yes.
So I'll probably tell you something I don't know if you know about me before the end of the next one. Completely.
Okay.
So this one actually did help me through a breakup, so I can't really say that anymore. Going to 1998 or 9.
Okay.
I don't know what year, and I'm not going to look it up because now I'm getting lazy. it's past my morning. but there is one album I think everybody and their mother owned.
Oh, boy.
And it is country pop.
Country pop.
Country pop.
Oh, you mean the genre?
Yeah.
The Dixie Chicks?
No, but...
Shania Twain.
There you go. And it's Come On Over.
Yes. Of course, it has to be.
So, fun story about Richard that not a lot of people know is back in 1999? Might have been 90. Yeah, it was 99. It was before freshman year. There was a lip sync contest always held at my town celebration. And yep, I dabbled into the world of drag that day.
Oh my God.
And did Man, I Feel Like a Woman.
That's awesome.
So, and then, by the way, that continued on for another 10 years afterwards. So I've done drag for 10 years after that. So I do everything. Has this surprised you at all yet?
I think this might be the most surprised that I've been.
You know, I guilty pleasure show. Just talked about this on the last episode of Live is RuPaul's Drag Race.
Mm-hmm.
Guilty pleasure show. And Shania Twain was a judge. And I went back to the time frame where it was just me, because I had really terrible stage fright, and doing Man, I Feel Like a Woman in front of 2,000 people took away that entire stage fright like I never had it.
Yeah.
But it also helped me through a couple of breakups. I had a crush on
Shania.
Yeah.
I wouldn't picture Shania Twain's Come On Over helping someone through a breakup.
It did.
Huh.
It did. What song was that? Don't Impress Me Much.
Oh yeah.
It's just kind of a dick anthem.
It like, is.
Look, you think you're all hot crap and stuff, and I'm trying not to. Yeah, and that song just tells you you pretty much suck.
Basically.
It was a good anthem. Yeah, no, I had a lot of my music taste is weird.
It's not weird. It's eclectic.
That's a fancy word for weird, kids. When someone says eclectic, it's a fancy word for, hey, you're weird.
I was trying to make you feel less bad.
No, it's cool. The one where she's doing the river dance, and I can't think of the song, like in the music video.
Mm-hmm.
Is probably also one of my favorite songs from that album.
Okay.
But I can't think of the song right now. But yeah, that's that album... That album inspired a lot of comedy for me.
Yeah. I mean, it's a fantastic album.
It, again, also used in house show music.
Yes.
So, yeah. I like to catch people off guard. I'm sorry, man.
No, it's cool. I'm you know, I'm a little speechless, but you know, that's okay. What else are podcasts for?
Yeah, no, that's what you get for working with me. I apologize.
You're cool. Don't ever apologize.
Well, I'll apologize for a lot of things, and it's probably my next one.
So my next one, it's going to be a little bit more serious. Takes it back to the 90s, the late 90s. And, God, people are probably going to get sick of me talking about this band and this singer.
It's Matchbox 20. We're already there. We're done.
It is Matchbox 20. One of my all-time favorite bands. Yourself or Someone Like You was
I love that band.
Huge success. It's their debut album.
3 a.m. is still
smash. Yes. This is one of my top three favorite albums of all time. And it's one of those albums that at the time it came out, I was in grammar school, so I wasn't listening. Like, they were not on my radar. But as I got into college later, this album came up, particularly like 3 a.m. came up, and you go back and you listen to this album, and it's like, holy crap, like song for song, like these guys, like, oh God, Rob Thomas is one of the best vocalists and songwriters music will ever see. And he doesn't even know it. Like I listened to an interview. He's so humble. He's like, I don't think I'm a good songwriter. I don't think so. And I'm like, what? Like, how could you not?
I appreciate that though, because there are some people who think their crap don't stink.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it just bothers you when you hear them. You know what Matchbox 20, what this album reminds me of, is every high school dance. And that's not a bad thing.
Really?
Yeah, because they used to play Matchbox 20 at every high school dance. Matchbox 20, Goo Goo Dolls, Savage Garden. There's like four other bands.
Yeah, I remember hearing like Goo Goo Dolls and Savage Garden at high school dances, but I don't remember hearing Matchbox 20.
Oh, they would play what? Like
at least not this album.
Yeah, it was this. There's just a bunch. Like, there was just this time frame where all of that music just... It's so good. I'm listening to that album when we get done with tonight's show. Like, when I go to work tonight, when I work on other stuff later tonight, I'm going to be listening to that Matchbox 20 album.
For me, this is one of my, like, comfort albums. And I don't mean that in a bad way. I mean it when, like, when I need to, like, and I say this, it's going to sound cheesy, but, like, when I need to, like, get back in touch with myself, or, like, when I'm having a depressing kind of day, or when I'm, you know, when I'm not depressed, when I'm just in a good mood, but I want something that's going to cheer me up, even though some of these songs are a little depressing. It's just one of those albums that really fits no matter what mood you're in. But for me, it's especially like, I don't know, it like, it's a soul searching kind of album. And I know that might not make sense considering some of the songs.
No, I get it.
I don't know if it's like his voice or what, but this album is just, they don't make albums like this anymore.
I think they do. I just think they're harder to find.
I said this when we were doing the 90s show. The 90s had this way of writing songs that were... They were complex but simple. And you didn't always know what they were talking about.
Right.
But somehow you knew when it related to you. Like, you just knew, like, you felt what they were saying. Even if you weren't 100% sure what they were saying, you felt what they were saying.
So I think
they don't write like that anymore.
This is true. 100%. I think before I get to my last, like, two, I think we're on number, what are we on, seven?
Yeah, I think so.
One, two, I'm counting. Three, four, five, six, seven. Yeah, this is actually number eight. Okay, cool.
Okay.
Before I go like into my two albums that actually influenced everything for me, mm-hmm. because one's really weird and one is just no one's going to see coming. I'm going to talk about something that influences me now.
Okay.
So I went for a time period where I just did not listen to new music. I don't know what it was. Like, I just didn't care. I was going through a depressed state. This is probably going to get deep for a second. In fact, I was hospitalized twice. There was a lot of terrible things going on. And I went, okay, so I've got, and you know, the doctor tells you, well, you got to do some stuff to try to make yourself better. Mm-hmm. All right, doctor. That's cool. And I started listening to music. And again, and not the music that I have on my playlist. I was trying to seek out new music because I needed that. Mm-hmm. And that's when I discovered, well, one, and everybody who knows me knows I love the ska genre. Mm-hmm. An honorable mention is Real Big Fish's Candy Coated Fury.
Nice.
That actually helped me through my end of my first marriage. So But there was a band I discovered at that same time frame.
Mm-hmm.
And she is an amazing talent. And she believes that everyone is their own superhero.
Is it Tsunami Bob?
No.
Oh.
It is. Her name is Michelle Beebs, but she has a band called Beebs and Her Moneymakers.
Okay.
And they are so... Her music is very positive, has a very positive message with mm-hmm. a fun sound, but she has a voice that could do 1960s blues.
Oh, wow.
Doing the ska kind of style. She has a cover of Wrecking Ball that is fantastic.
Really?
Yeah, it's not on this album, but she also does a few other covers. But this one is worst album ever, and it's worst, like, spelled in bratwurst. I told you, they're fun. But that album helped me so much, and we actually started talking, because I inducted her into the hall. It's one of the only few times I've rarely ever went out of my way to induct someone who's in the independent genre.
Yeah.
That's not mainstream, and eventually, our wires always get crossed, but I've been trying to get her booked on an episode of Live.
Nice.
So, but yeah, this album, there's so many good songs on this album that when you hear them, you'll just have a smile on your face after listening.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, I need, at the time when I found them, I needed that. Yeah. And I went out of my way to see them within 2 months of finding them. This tells you anything. And there's a picture of Nutsy with her.
Oh, wow.
On the website, I think. But yeah, she's an amazing talent. I highly recommend going to find her. So anytime I am starting to work on a new project, that is the album that automatically starts playing first.
That's awesome.
See, I got real.
Yes. And I feel like that's what like these kind of lists do. Like they bring out like memories or moments or emotions that you wouldn't normally like maybe bring up in a conversation.
No.
And that's what I love about music.
Completely agree with that.
So my next one. So originally I had, going back to the pop punk genre, I had The Academy Is on here. They're
doing, is it Good here. Charlotte?
Is it what?
Is it Good Charlotte?
No. Oh. The Academy Is, their debut album, Almost Here. I originally had that on here because that album from front to back, amazing. But I think I'm switching it out for one of my I thought was a runners up, because the more I look at it, this album that I'm actually picking, which is, people are gonna laugh, you're gonna be surprised, I'm sure.
It can't be any worse than are you gonna say Sugar Ray Floored?
No. Sugar Cult, their debut album.
Love Sugar Cult. Love Sugar Cult.
Again, it came out at a time, high school, when the lyrics, the song, Hate Every Beautiful Day, You're the One, Stuck in America, Saying Goodbye, How Does It Feel? I mean, Bouncing Off the Walls. Like, this album was just, like, it lifted you up. It brought you down. It, you could take out your anger. Like,
the best albums will make you go through every gamut of emotion in the span of 40 minutes.
Yes. And, I mean, people can say what they want about the pop punk genre, but their lyrics were some of the best lyrics you'll find in music. Some of. Because, I mean, they just... It may not sound like it, but they really were digging deep. I truly believe that. Like, I don't know how else to explain it. People remember Sugar Cult for about the song, I'm Bouncing Off the Walls Again. But, I mean, there was just so much more to them. I remember, like, coming home after a bad day at school, or when you're going through all these different emotions with your boyfriend, or somebody who you wanted to be your boyfriend, or whatever the case was, and you put on a song like How Does It Feel, and you just you're in your feelings, to quote the kids these days,
all up in their feels, all up in your own feels.
And I mean, it was songs like this that brought that out in you before any of the music today ever could. I don't know, it just like I don't know how else to explain it. It was emotional to the core, and that's probably where the term emo came from, obviously. But
emo music,
people listening to this are probably thinking, oh my God, she doesn't, what, seriously, like, she's trying to be a music journalist? Like, she doesn't know anything about music. Because I'm not explaining it well verbally, but.
No, here's the thing. I feel when you're passionate about something, sometimes you can't find the words.
Right.
And the perfect example of that is when you find an album you absolutely love because you can't describe it. When you want a friend to listen to an album you love, you don't just tell them, hey, you need to listen to this album. You just start playing for it for their ass when they sit down in your car.
Exactly.
So, all right, I kind of changed my mind.
Uh-oh.
Well, it's not one of those. I got emotional in the last one and went, okay, there is an honorable mention that I could talk about, and I feel, okay, there was one on my list I don't feel actually fits anymore when I wrote this. Yeah, no, but I'll go ahead and it's an honorable mention.
Okay.
It is Running with Scissors by Weird Al.
Only, I knew Weird Al was going to be on your list.
Well,
I just knew it.
Well, it's not now, but but because of Albuquerque, I was doing that as my speech piece for tournaments. Mm-hmm. So I actually took a Weird Al song and turned it into a script.
That's creativity.
That song is 13 minutes long.
Oh my God.
So you had to have a 10-minute piece without the bridges and everything and the long pauses, and it was 9:50.
Wow.
And I went, this is perfect. So yeah, and I took that to state that year, so hey. But we're Running with Scissors, which also has the Saga Begins from episode 1 of Star Wars, was on my list.
Nice.
I have changed my mind.
Uh-oh.
I.
What are you swapping it out for?
Well, I'm going to get real again. Like, my next two are real. Apologize. I had the Spice Girls. I feel like you owe me. 1997, my dad died.
Okay.
And I remember my mom searching for the perfect song for him. Mm-hmm. And we had a cassette, which was not mine. When we bought a cassette, it was everyone's cassette. I don't know if anyone else did that with music. Like, you didn't have your own music when you were 8, but yeah.
Yeah.
But one of the albums that I couldn't stand as a kid now makes me think of my mom and dad so much that... every time I feel sad or, you know, like, hey, they're both gone now, I always think about them now when I listen to this album.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. It is country.
It's country.
It's country, and it's from 1991.
Is it Garth?
Nope.
Is it Tim McGraw?
Nope. You're never. Look, you can try and name every male country artist you can think of in the span of the next 2 minutes, and you probably would never hit this on the head.
Is it a well-known country artist from the 90s?
I guess. I don't know how to put it. Like, he had more than one hit.
Okay. So I'm going to go not, like, mainstream. So not a Garth or a Tim.
No. Not on that level.
So
not
like a Joe Diffie or Sawyer Brown.
Probably in that level. So a little bit more. Yeah.
Okay. But it's one single guy, not a band.
It's one single guy.
Okay. So I already said Joe Diffie and, Sawyer Brown.
I do love Sawyer Brown though. For anybody who doesn't know, Sawyer Brown is the shiz, and they put on one hell of a show.
Yeah. David Lee Murphy, but I don't, like, he never had any, like, serious songs.
Are you telling me Dust on the Bottle? Is it Dust on the Bottle? Yeah.
Yeah. It's a serious song, but, like, it's more, like, now it's become, like, a cult classic, like a sing-along. One of the best songs in country music you'll ever hear. I'm trying to think who else. Toby Keith is too mainstream for it to be him.
It's also 1991.
1991. Give me a hint.
I don't think you're going to get it, honestly. I can't even give you a hint.
Don't underestimate me.
No, here's the thing. I can't give you a hint because I don't know how many hints I can give because I only know him for like 4 songs.
Huh.
But the album is All I Can Be by Colin Ray.
Oh, okay. I do know Colin Ray.
Yeah, I mean, everyone knows of Colin Ray, but you wouldn't know of Colin Ray unless you were seeking out Colin Ray.
Right.
It was their favorite album together.
Mm-hmm.
It makes me miss them. When I start feeling down that they're not around, I'll play it.
Yeah.
That's probably what I'm going to say.
He had a song, and it was probably his most popular song. One of the most beautiful songs you'll ever hear. I think it's called Love Me, right?
That was played at their funeral.
Yeah.
That song, anytime I hear, if I'm on the radio, if I'm listening to the radio, which is very rare for me, because I always have, nowadays you're going to put on your playlist. You don't want to listen to commercials. Screw that nonsense.
Right.
Or podcast. I mean, that's really what people listen to. But every so often when I listen to country radio and they play that song, it's just a calm. I just go quiet and calm.
Yeah.
It's kind of sad. I got more emotional in this show than I think I've had in any other show in the last 3 years.
Oh.
Yeah. All right. That's we're good. I don't need to cry on a show.
People are going to think that I included a lot of pop punk albums on this list because
nerd
people think of me now as the country girl. She only covers country. She only likes country music. That is not true.
That is actually the case, though. I get a message every so often going, "Hey, does she like any other music besides country?" And I go, "Yes, it's polka, but I don't think you want to hear."
Some dumbass is going to take you seriously.
Okay, so someone sent me seven messages. This is a long time ago. This is probably a year and a half ago. Somebody sent me seven or eight messages going, "Do you guys cover anything else other than country?" And I said, "Well, we would cover polka." And they went, I was not going to be happy with the smartass answer. And then you gave me maybe the weirdest smartass answer you can go. And you have a fan for life. I will never not read anything. And I went, yes.
That's awesome. A lot of people now, like I said, they just assume that I only listen to country. But back in the day, teenage, high school, college, Amanda was all about the pop punk and hard rock. And then, and then some alternative rock. But pop punk was my main one true love at that time. So for that reason, I always have a soft spot for the genre. And the bands that came out of the 2000s pop punk scene are some of my favorites. And the albums are some of my all-time favorites. And this next one is... the band have since, gone off the rails. Fall Out Boy.
Ooh, that new album is a dumpster fire. Yeah.
But their debut album, their first full-length album, because I believe, if I'm doing this correctly, there was a EP that they first came out with. I think it was an EP that had the song, something about John Cusack. My memory escapes me right now, but their first full-length debut album, Take This to Your Grave, that was my favorite album of all time back in the day. And it's, like I said, it's up there, and that's why it's on this most influential list. Dear God, if those weren't some of the most raw, real, heartbreaking lyrics, Tell that Mickey just made my list of things to do today. I'm going to get this lyric wrong thinking about it now, but it was basically stop burning bridges and drive off of them. I mean, come on, no one writes like that. That's what made Fall Out Boy so different. And I mean, they got right down to it. This is just one of those albums, again, song for song, you can't skip through it.
I think my first introduction to Fall Out Boy was Grand Theft Auto.
Yeah.
And outside that, I know the song you're talking about with John Cusack, but I can't think of the title. I know more of the other albums
than I think a lot of this one. Do.
Yeah. I mean, I know of it. I don't think I've listened to it in a consistent basis. Not as much as I have the other.
Yeah.
Because Under the Cork Tree, good grief.
I mean, I get it. Again, that's what brought them the mainstream success. But this album, if you were a true diehard fan, this was the album. This goes down as one of the greatest pop punk albums.
You know, I think every show has had a mention. Oh, crap. I can't think of his name now. Pete Wentz? Yeah, no, the other, the lead singer.
Patrick Stump.
Yeah, no, I would have been shot if this was the Winos. Because you know who does the Winos theme? It's Patrick Stump.
I love Patrick Stump.
His solo career is weird.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. There was somewhere I was going with this, but I think this is now every show has had a Patrick Stump reference except the wrestling shows, and even they might have at this point. Like, dude's a dreamboat. That's all I'm going to say.
He is. And I mean, he, oh God, if you haven't heard this album, just, I might listen to it tomorrow morning on my way to work. Like, if you haven't heard this album, go back and listen to it. It's, and you know, it still holds up today. And one of the best, and I wish I could have seen them do the song live at Wrigley Field over the summer, but I just couldn't. But to hear Chicago Is So 2 years Ago, I mean, there's a light on in Chicago, and I know you should be home, or something along those lines. God, I'm getting old because I'm struggling to remember lyrics now. God, there's just, these songs were just, these lyrics were just intricate and to the point, but it was like following a roadmap, and it took so many twists and turns to get to the point, but yet it still managed to like cut to the core.
It's a good album.
It's just a phenomenal album.
Like I said, I don't really think about it as much because I think of the other stuff, but
No, this was, if like I said, if you're a hardcore fan, especially if you care more about the lyrics, because From Under the Cork Tree brought it to the masses, and it was more like about like the Hollywood-esque type stuff. Take This to Your Grave was the heart of the matter. This was all about relationships and heartbreak and bitterness over a heartbreak, and I think that's why I loved it so much, because again, it came out at a time, you know, when I was in high school, when that's all I was dealing with. And it just, it hits you in your feelings.
All right. I think we have one more each.
Yes.
Okay. Well, all right. I'm actually kind of going to do something sentimental, but not as sad. The album kind of is, but there is one song on that album that has influenced my career ever since I heard the song. So when I discovered that I actually enjoyed performing in front of people, I went, okay, I know what I want to do. And I would always tune into television, and I'd watch stand-ups. No, this is not a stand-up album. But it's actual music, because I did consider that. And I went, no, this is a music show. So I would watch stand-up comics, and very, very rarely at like age 12 and 13, you would find someone who would resonate with you. And one day I was flipping through the channels, and I came across this special. It was hosted by Bob Saget.
Oh, Bob Saget.
Bob Saget's awesome. And it was him and Mary Lou Henner.
Okay.
You want to talk about a random pairing. But they were talking about a certain comic who never branded himself as a comic.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to give that name away unless you, I mean, if you know me, you know where I'm going with this. But I got to learn all about this guy and all about his escapades of fooling people and being a dick to crowds and being an asshat and just doing horrible impressions to do one great one.
Mm-hmm.
So after he passes in 1999 or 1984, this is way before me, but he passed in 1984. And his legacy still lives on because people wondered if he was dead.
Okay.
And during that special, I got introduced to a band. So I might be 10 at this time, honestly, that I have never heard before at this point. And I'm not by no means dissing this band because I love them, but I never knew how much words would speak to me until I heard Man on the Moon by R.E.M.
Really?
Yeah. It's about Andy Kaufman. And so probably my most influential album. Because when I started doing stand-up, I studied Andy Kaufman.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's definitely a weird guy. He was a weird guy.
Yeah.
But the album that Man on the Moon is part of is Automatic for the People. And that is my last one.
Wow.
Yeah, not one you were expecting, right?
No, not at all.
I love R.E.M., and I never really got into R.E.M., But I knew of the song, and then I discovered more REM.
Yeah.
Yeah. I also didn't realize he was the one of the, he was the fake, Michael Stipe was the fake ice cream man on Beat and Beat. So yeah, Man on the Moon, probably the most iconic song for my career.
Wow.
Yeah. There you go.
That's interesting. I would have never guessed that.
Yeah, no, I told you. Like, it took me a while to come up with the list, but when I did come up with the list, I got the list.
Yeah.
All right.
So my number one, it also happens to be probably my number one favorite album of all time as well, by one of my favorite bands of all time.
Ooh. I'm not going to say, guess? I'm not going to say Nickelback. I guarantee you. I'm just going to promise everybody. I'm not saying Nickelback. Could it be? I'm trying to think of just something off the wall random. I can't do it. I was going to say, is it?
Well, we've briefly talked about them before.
Oh, is it Aha?
No, really? no, actually, it is Lifehouse.
What?
Yes.
Just completely take me off guard. Oh, my goodness.
Really?
No, it's just I don't hate them. I don't love them. It's kind of they're neutral.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
I guess.
Like, I'll listen, if the song's on, I'll listen to it, like, their main song.
Yeah, Hanging by a Moment.
Yeah, but that song got killed for me to the point where I just don't listen to them anymore. I could probably do it now, but our radio stations back home overkilled the shit out of that song.
Well, so that's what everyone knows them for, is Hanging by a Moment.
Right.
But their debut album, No Name Face, came out in 2000, and I remember sitting in a car and for like waiting for my friend, and the radio was on. And again, this was when, you know, Chicago had an alternative rock station, Q101, and this song came on and it stopped me in my tracks. Like, I had to turn it up and really listen to it, because I hadn't heard anything else like this before. You know, it came right after the 90s. So it bridged the gap perfectly between the 90s angst and the 2000s pop. And it was this alternative rock sound that it was serious, and it wasn't like jokester or anything. It dug deep, kind of like it dug deep enough to where it was like Matchbox 20, but not too deep to where you didn't know what they were talking about. Like, it was just deep enough. And this album, Hanging by a Moment, is a great song. It's still one of my favorite songs. But this album, there's not, and I keep saying this line, but there's not a bad song on this album. These songs just, they really, like, and I don't want to keep using the same phrases over and over, like they hit you in your feelings or anything, but the songs on here, they're just, there's a song on here, so Somewhere in Between. And I quote this in my bio. It is probably the one, like, the singular song that can sum up my life. And, you know, the chorus is basically like, I'm somewhere in between what's real and what's a dream. And I feel like that's kind of like where I live my life. Like, I know what's real, and but sometimes you don't want to live in reality. You want to live in fantasy, because at the end of the day, like, let's be real, most days fantasy is a lot better than reality.
Oh, understood. Very true.
And, you know, you kind of, for me, I live somewhere in between the two. I know what's real and I know what's not, but I prefer the middle. I prefer the middle, somewhere in between, because it's I don't want to say it's safer, but it's just a better place. And
I get, you know, where you're coming from.
You got to listen to the lyrics of that song. I try and quote them now, I'm going to mess it up.
They have great lyrics. Again, it's just when you hear, I think it's just what radio does. And especially,
yeah, and when, I get that.
Because there's a lot of songs that they've done that to.
Yeah. And this album was just so underrated. I mean, oh God, you know, Someone Else's Song, Cling and Clatter, Breathing, Quasimodo, Simon, which was written for one of their friends, who dealt with a lot of bullying as a teenager, as a child. and you listen to that song, and you know, it still holds up today when you go back and listen to it. You know, I know people don't see like adults as being bullied, but
it happens.
It happens. And you know, it's, for me, it's one of those things where like you think about it, and even though this album came out when I was in high school, it reminds you of like grammar school. For me as an adolescent girl, grammar school was the worst, and this song kind of takes you back to that. But it doesn't like, it doesn't make you feel sad. It just makes you feel, it makes you feel sad for humanity, really. Because you see like how bad people can be. But then it goes and it tells you like, it just makes you feel better about yourself, like not to let people bring you down. And again, like, you know, Matchbox 20's Yourself or Someone Like You, this album, it's one of my, like, my comfort albums when I need to get, when I'm in a certain headspace, I turn this album on and it's just, it's peaceful. Like it just, it quiets the noise.
So you bring up Lifehouse and I looked them up because I was like, I want to look more. And I got taken to a world of Twitter.
A world of Twitter?
Why? A world of Twitter. And there's a music festival that I feel is more important, that would, it, that sounds better than the two we read earlier.
Really?
Yes.
And what is that?
It is called Caboodle Del Mar, or Caboodle El Mar. It's in Del Mar, California.
Okay.
Here's the lineup of the first four lines.
Uh-oh.
Five lines. For me to let you know how many, like, I don't know what day people are on, but here we go. Kings of Leon, Dave Matthews Band, Mumford & Sons, Duran Duran, Black Eyed Peas,
oh my God,
One Republic, Maren Morris,
wow,
Sheryl Crow,
no way,
Snoop Dogg,
huh,
the Wu-Tang Clan, what? Mark Ronson,
this lineup just went off the rails,
The Revivalist, REO Speedwagon,
oh my God.
The Bengals.
Can Kevin Cronin even still sing?
I don't know. The Bengals. The Cult. Sublime with Rome.
What?
Boys to Men.
Oh, Jesus.
Colby Calais.
Oh, wow.
Squeeze.
Huh?
The 80s band.
Yeah.
Lifehouse.
Oh my God.
Switchfoot.
Oh, wow.
Plain White Tees. And not to mention, and there's a lot more bands that I, you know, bands you don't hear of, you've never heard of.
Yeah.
Not to mention, they also have comedy acts, complete with Pete Holmes and Friends, Wayne freaking Brady, Bob Saget, Kevin Smith, Tom Green.
Okay, one, where is Del Mar, California?
It's two, by San Diego.
When does this happen?
September.
Wow.
Like, this is now the music festival I need to go to. Like, screw everything else. This is now the festival.
See, and I always thought that, like, you know, like there's festivals like Warped Tour, and they used to do another one.
This was announced today.
Where, oh, was it?
Yeah.
So, you know, there's festivals like Warped Tour and other ones that do that focus on the pop punk, ska, and, you know, other forms of rock genre. And then you have, you know, you've had hard rock festivals like, and metal festivals like Ozfest and
for anybody
the
else.
One that, I can't think of the name of it, but the one that just came back for this year in Chicago. And, you know, you've got North Carolina Rebellion and all these, you know, hard rock and metal festivals. And then you have country festivals, you know, Lake Shake and Country Thunder and all that. But what I always thought that there needed to be is, and I don't know what in the world we would call it, but there needs to be a festival for bands like the Matchbox 20s and Lifehouse and Switchfoot and Sister Hazel's and Vertical Horizon. And
you mean a completely 90s, like 90s, early 2000s, Vertical Horizon? Are you kidding me?
I love that band. Like, their first album, really.
I know that one song. I actually thought a long time ago, so if this show takes off, we might try one. Like, if we ever get to that point money-wise, we might try a festival. Like, we might do, like, a one-day festival of just 90s bands and see what happens.
There needs to be, because that alt-rock, pop-rock, soft-rock genre, whatever you want to call it, is so underrated, and those bands are just some of the best bands in music.
And anytime I can book letters to Cleo, I'm all about it.
Yes. Yeah, thank you. 10 Things I Hate About You.
And Parks and Rec.
Oh, see, I never got into Parks and Rec.
At the end of the run, they do like this huge Pawnee music festival, and Letters to Cleo is one of the bands, and the character of Ben Wyatt's wearing his Letters to Cleo t-shirt, and he's freaking out, and I'm like, that's me. If I'm ever doing anything, that's me. All right.
So we made it through our first episode, our most influential albums of all time. And hopefully people continue to tune in every week to Striking a Chord. Thank you for making this happen and being a part of it and joining me on this crazy ride.
There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with it.
Yeah. And so next week we'll have a little bit more. For those of you who are not a fan, you can decide to tune out now. But next week is going to be a little bit more of the Nashville side of things. We're going to have somebody from one of my friends in Nashville on, and we're going to, I believe what we're doing, unless it's changed by now, is we're going to dig into a specific artist catalog, an artist who's very underrated and not so mainstream anymore.
I want to make the joke right now. Can I? Can I? Just one more time. Go ahead. Is it Nickelback? I'm done. No.
I have this, like, weird feeling that you just have, like, a poster of Chad Kroeger, like, in your bedroom.
No, but how great would it be to hear Chad Kroeger try country music?
Oh, God. He has got to be, like, the number one, like, probably, like, most hated person in music.
Yeah, thanks next for to screwed, Kanye. I was going to say, thanks for screwing up Avril. Until now, she's back.
Yeah, but right.
There was a time frame. I'm looking at you, Chad. All right, go ahead. I'm sorry.
So, yeah. So, next week will be more of our, like, Nashville edition. And so, we'll have more new music for you. And more concert announcements. And so our feature segment next week is really going to be, is going to focus on one specific artist and kind of digging into their catalog. So if you're a country fan, definitely tune in next week. Otherwise, we have a whole lot more stuff coming.
Just to let everyone know, I think one of the things you have not mentioned is there were going to be shows with interviews.
Yes, there are. I'm sorry. as it gets later on in the night, like, my mind starts to get away from me. But yes, there are going to be shows, episodes where the feature segment will be an interview with an artist or a band, whoever I'm fortunate enough to get an interview with.
I'm going to send you a message of someone. We're working on those. I'm going to send you a message of somebody I want.
Okay.
That you have talked to.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm not going to say it on the show because I don't want to jinx it.
Yeah. But yeah, so especially with summer coming, hopefully if I get, you know, press passes for certain festivals coming up, we'll be able to air the interviews on the podcast. And it'll get the content out a lot faster. So, and it's not just going to be country artists. It's, like I said, like, I'm working on trying to, you know, hopefully get interviews with, you know, Lizzie Hale from Hailstorm and, God willing, you know, Alice Cooper.
Again, if if you get Nita Strauss, I'm coming.
Yeah. but I mean, like we said earlier, there's no genre is off limits for this podcast. So definitely don't tune out just because you think it's going to be all country music.
All right. I know this is a new experience for a lot of people because I'm usually the one that does this, but this is your chance to say goodnight, everybody.
Good night, everybody. For those of you listening in the morning, good morning. I don't know. Or good afternoon. So good night. It's 10 o'clock at night here in the Midwest. And tune in next week to Striking a Chord. I'm Madd Manda, and you've been listening to TBK Radio.